everybody. Can I welcome you to this meeting of Health Education England's board? That doesn't all go well. I can't even say it this morning. You're all very welcome. So thanks very much for joining this morning. Nicola, do you just want to do a roll call and then we'll get going? And I think you're on mute, Nicola.
It's right on mute.
There you go, you're off mute now.
Changed. Oh!
You're back
on mute again.
It was showing me still on mute. So on the call we have Andrew George, Alex Wallace, David Farrelly, Ella Clifford, Andrew Foster, Giles Denham, Joe Lenehan, John Latham, Laura Roberts, Lee Whitehead, Liz Benton, Liz May, Mark Radford, Naveena Mitchell, Raze Lunat, Sandra White, Shona McLeod, Sir David Behan, Soraya Dillon, Vicky Diaz, Vidushi Golash, Wendy Reid, and Keith Wright. We also have, just popping in, Luke Williams and Giles Denham.
Okay, Giles is here twice, so welcome twice, Giles. That's fantastic. Right, we've got an absolutely packed agenda and we've got some guests joining us at particular points during our agenda. So with your permission, colleagues, I'm going to try and share this broadly to those times because I don't think we've got a lot of catch-up time as I've looked at this agenda over the past couple of days. So normally if we overrun on something, I can work out where we're going to make it up, but it's not as clear on this agenda. So if you could help me with that, I'd appreciate that. So let's get into it straight away. So after... welcome and apologies. We move on to item two, which is the declarations of interest. They're published in our papers today. Does any member of the board want to make an update to any of the declarations? No, if we could accept those then as an accurate description of the other interests that board member colleagues have. So the next item then is to come to the minutes of our meeting on the 16th of March. And I'll take them pages 1 to 6. Are you content with the accuracy of the minutes from our meeting on the 16th of March? David Farrell is nodding at me. I'll take that as a... thanks, Naveena, you as well. So I'll take that as a... an accurate reflection. Thank you, Nicola, and well done again. So any matters arising that are not elsewhere on our agenda, and again, I'll take pages 1 to 6. If you indicate if you want to raise anything, just pause for a second. No, the 9 people, I can see there's 2 of you shaking your head, so I'll take that as a decision. So again, thank you for that. So if I can then turn to item 5, which is a verbal update from the chairs of our committees. And these are the meetings which have taken place recently. And my agenda is saying, Liz, you'll just give us an update on the People's Advisory Forum. And I think we have Phil Huff with us, who's one of the co-chairs of the People Advisory Forum as well. So, but Liz, if I ask you to kick it off, please.
OK, I will do it, David. So we've got 2 items on the agenda for People's Advisory Forum. I'll whiz through the minutes from Wednesday's meeting and we've got a formal presentation a bit further down the agenda, I think, that Phil's going to go through as well. So we had our meeting last Wednesday, well attended, and we've got a real sort of good mix of people on the People's Advisory Forum. We've been out to advert specifically to look at how we increase the diversity of the group. As you say, David, we've got a new co-chair, Phil Huff. It was his first meeting in that capacity. We went through something that's coming up on the agenda, actually. We went through the HE COVID report infographic, which was feedback from our trainees about how they'd experienced the COVID period, and we went into that in quite a lot of detail, and it fits with an item on the board agenda. And we were particularly interested in some of the concerns from ethnic minority students about lack of placement in support and their experiences in the pandemic. So I think we're going to come onto that later in the board agenda. And we were focusing down as well on the flexibility being put in place by universities to support students with catch-up, and we had quite a long discussion about that. PATH members attend HE committees and groups, and we went through some of their experiences and the feedback on every single group we go to. So we've got a PATH member on the patient safety board, and I know the patient safety syllabus is coming up on the board agenda today, so we'd had a discussion about that. And we did have a discussion about a group that was attended by one of the PATH members about medical rotations and the short notice that medical trainees are given when they have to move across the country, maybe sometimes with families, and we sort of raised that as a concern to flag with HE. Naveena really helpfully came along, so it's great to have Naveena coming along to the meetings and gave us an update on some of the strategic work of HE, but also how she wants PATH really to be involved in planning the work, get this culture of people participation that we're building across the organisation fits really well with PATH and our ambition about co-production and working together. So that was really welcomed by members. And then Lee also came along and gave us a presentation about the work that we're doing around making HE the best place to work. Members were really sort of engaged in that, felt that it would be great for PATH to be involved in that as well. So although they're not formal staff members, that they would really like to work on HE being the best place to work. And we had we always have an update from Mark, who's our SRO, about COVID this time and the vaccinations. And people were really sort of congratulating Mark on all the work he's done to getting the vaccination to that stage. So really positive meeting, David, and lots came out of it that we can pick up in today's board and going forward.
Okay, sounds absolutely packed, Liz. Thank
it
you.
Was.
Thank you. Yeah. But that sounds fantastic, and really good to see that voice feeding back and being amplified at the board as well. So we look forward to the item later. And well done to you as well, Mark. Thank you. So, John Latham, do you want to? You also met yesterday, I think.
Yeah, we did meet yesterday. And Andrew, do pick up, because Andrew had to chair just at the beginning. Then I picked up as we were on the internal audit reports. Again, a packed agenda, really. And the big item was the last item yesterday, which we're running through, of course, which is around the sort of annual report and accounts. And there's a lot of work going on in that space, and I'll give lots of credit, as we did at the end of the meeting yesterday, to everyone for being able to get the document into such a really good position, even though it's still draft, in such a short period of time, considering both the scale and the amount of information that needs to be put into this. And I think it's fair to say that the document looks a lot better than we were at this time last year, and there'll be a lot of effort over the next few days. Nicola would like it done by Friday, of course, to try and get us into a position where we've got a sort of real draft ready document for us to be looking at and reviewing. A lot of information in there, which is quite important. The sort of standard business of the agenda was long, and but in many ways not particularly surprising, so no difficulties really being raised in the rest of the agenda. We looked at the sort of legal cases. We looked at the corporate risk register, which is now, of course, a combined COVID and standard risk register in terms of where that is. Very good performance there. If anything, the question is, it's a very good performance. Therefore, you know, we need to review all of the risks that we've identified, because we seem to be doing very well in what is a risky time. So again, and I think Nicola said that the executive is reviewing that sort of risk register now to see if there are new things which are coming through. But other standard things, looking at counter fraud activity, which of course is quite high in profile in sort of nationally at the moment, but a lot of very good and positive work going there in terms of what's going on. Tender waivers, again, nothing in particular we looked at. Losses and special payments, again, standard report, nothing particularly out of kilter. There were a number of internal audit reports, and Andrew, please add in, because I came in on the sort of data warehouse review one, and I think the data warehouse review for me is quite a key element. Personally, I actually think that, you know, HE has always been very data rich, and now we're getting to a point where we're really able to use the data. But with the complexities of the interactions with all of our stakeholders, I think it's key now that we really do start to lever the power of the data that we've got, and to ensure that we've got one version of the truth, and we can use that to support both the case, to support AGE, but the way in which we run our own business. And I think that there's a lot of positive feeling about the direction of travel that we're in, and a very good report, actually. But now it's looking at what the potential of what that could be as we move forward. And quite an interesting general report, really, on managing risks in the NHS. You know, we're not NHS, but I think as they said, you know, we've got NHS on our logo, and there's elements that we need to look across to see what other parts of the NHS are dealing with. So quite interesting things in there that we need to keep under review, I think, as we move forward. Andrew, I don't know if there was anything in the sort of first two or three items that you covered that you want to pick up.
No, John, I think I would echo what you were saying very much around the data warehouse, and the other reports were, you know, minor things were picked up as you would expect, but nothing that was outstanding. I think we talked to the executive about them all, and I have no concerns about that. This was on the committee as well, so yeah, nothing to add.
Okay. Fine, so unless anybody's got any questions.
Yep. Good. John, thank you. Andrew, George, thank you. And thanks to other board colleagues that are on that committee. It sounds like you got through a lot of work yesterday. And Nicola, we look forward to the annual report. So, yeah, okay, thanks. Just a small point, John. I just wonder, whilst we're not an NHS frontline delivery service, I think we are legally and constitutionally part of the NHS.
Yes.
I wouldn't want the recording of the minutes just to creep into history without us just making that slight tweak on that particular point.
No, that's fine. I think you're right. And I think that the main thing for us is we did note really that a lot of the risks that are in that sort of standard NH really do apply to us, and you know, lots of things, you know, generic things, including things like Brexit, of course, and what that might do on the impact of recruitment and those kinds of things.
Yeah, and I think that is the key point, actually, John and Andrew. I think we've had this conversation on this board before, haven't we, about how we can have a risk register of a particular colour, but other bits of the system could be experiencing quite significant issues, and that makes that point quite significantly, John. And as I say, it's a theme that we've had on our board meetings, and a number of people shaking their head at that point. So, but listen, John, thanks to you and other colleagues for everything you do on this committee. It's usually an important opportunity for this board to take assurance that you and your colleagues are really scrutinising this work. And Andrew, George, it sounds like you got the gig of going to the arm's length body audit and risk committee meeting, annual event. So over to you.
Thank you. Can I just go back to Pusong? Because I think I really should have said as well that one of the internal audits was around the COVID response of HEE. And it was very complimentary about many of the things that HE had done in terms of changed ways of working, of IT and so on and so forth. It made suggestions of things that one should think about, but frankly, those were all suggestions made with 2020 hindsight, and were reasonable, and they gave a very glowing commendation to HE for that one. And I should probably say as well, the external audit was similarly positive. Okay, so yes, I went on behalf of John to the Arms Length Bodies ARC Chairs events. I won't take it too long. I think the interesting one was the presentation, but there cut some presentations picking up the point that you just made, Chair, around working between different arm's length bodies, and how the risks, how the DHSC needs to look at the risks across all of the arm's length bodies. And they clearly do have mechanisms of doing that one. I think that there are some really interesting interdependencies that need some more thought, particularly round about where the risk appetites are different for the same area but in different ALBs, and how you deal with different risk appetites for those areas. And I think that's something that will carry on needing discussion. The other thing that they were also very keen on, and we discussed this slightly yesterday when we came to the annual report, was that while everybody understands things had to be put to one side during the COVID pandemic, we have got to keep some things going, and that the NAO had thought that as a whole, they weren't talking about HEE, they were feeling as a whole, that we had perhaps given up too much about transparency during the COVID, and that we needed perhaps to concentrate more on things like transparency. And that there were also lessons to be learned between the tension between central grip and coordination and local expertise, and that this was something that they were very interested in. Now, I think that in many ways that's probably played out less for HEE than for other bodies in this one, but obviously has been important for providers in particular. And also they were very stressed on the needs of the accounts to be open and frank about what's not been possible to have control, and keeping on issues around value for money while supporting the achievements of staff. The other thing that we looked at was was a slight tendency in the current situation to set heroic deadlines rather than realistic deadlines for submitting things. And one that is a lesson for audit committees and perhaps for this board, and that the NAO reckoned that the COVID pandemic, quoting them, and I think this is slightly harsh, but I will quote them, points to a failure in imagination of audit committees and organisations in preparing for low likelihood, high risk events. And so how do we as a group really prepare for these low likelihood, high risk events? And that was a challenge for us. We also then heard, but most of the people around the table will be aware of this, around from Clara Swinson and Lee McDonough, how to how we were going to move forward into recovery. But I think that's fairly well rehearsed now. But what was absolutely central in all of their arguments was the workforce strategy, and that was absolutely key in everything they'd said. So I'll stop there and be happy to respond on their behalf to any questions.
Thanks, Andrew. Really helpful to get that national perspective so we can just put some of our own work into context, and really helpful. Does anybody want to come back on, Andrew? Okay, let's... Liz, John, Andrew, thanks for that. In my haste to get through the agenda, I rather swept over item 4 on my desire to get to item 5. So if we could just backtrack a step, that's the board agenda planner. I'm inviting the board to note it, but I don't know whether anybody wants to make any comments on that planner. Nicola, anything you want to add?
No, Chair, it's a comprehensive document now. We continue to build on it with individual discussions with members of the executive team. So we've got a full schedule for the year ahead, and we're also mirroring it for our committees.
Yeah, and just to reflect, one of the conversations that David Farrelly, Navina and I had yesterday is just making sure that all the, with Andrew George as well, sorry, Andrew, all the committees precede the board, which is taking the reports for that quarter, and then the board can have some assurance that the committees have had an opportunity to spend more time with some of the items coming to the board. So I think there's been some adjustment of dates of committees just to make sure that that happens. But that's all part of just making sure that the rhythm of our committees and the board meeting all feed into each other. But I think we're virtually there. And I know David Farrelly and members of the exec team are doing quite a bit of work on this. But in terms of subjects for our meetings, I think they're all set out there. And I hope that plays to one of Andrew's points about transparency, of letting people know what we're going to bring, but also the fact that the majority of what we take at a public board meeting as well. So, with transparency, let me hand over to Navina, and Navina, invite you to make your presentation of your report. Thanks.
Thank you, Sir David. So I will summarise the main points in the interest of time and leave some time for discussion. So I'm going to start with giving the board an update on our work together with partners on developing a people and workforce strategy in the people plan. So on the 18th of March, Sir David and I, together with partners in NHS EI and the department, brought together over 100 health and care leaders as part of the People Plan Advisory Group to share and test out our priorities for recovery as well as long-term people and workforce strategy. A really good session, plenty of themes that emerged around the need to focus on the long-term, which is obviously one of our big priorities, and at the same time delivering tangible change for people now and building on the progress that has been made in the past year. The National People Board, which I jointly chair with Prerna Issa, Chief People Officer, we met for the second time on the 8th of April. And at that People Board, we discussed themes around looking after our people and growing for the future. And we had excellent presentations from Matthew Taylor, who is now appointed as the Chief Executive of the NHS Confederation, on what makes good work, and that really helped us in the discussion. And also our very own Rob Smith on a presentation around the future of workforce planning, again, stimulated some really good discussion amongst the group for us to take forward for our work. Next, I'd like to just give the board some information about how HEE is developing our own operating model. From March last month, the executive and regional directors agreed to support development of a formal programme of work to look at all levers at all levels to make sure our operating model is robust and also in line with the changes that we expect to see coming forward. It has an internal focus, but really important to support externally our partners in the wider health and care system. So our programme will be closely aligned to the NHS E&I four pillars of change. These are just to give you a highlight. They are ICS implementation and development, NHS EI operating model, so we're making sure that we're closely aligned with that model, our approach, an approach to improvement, and system oversight planning. So we can bring updates on how we're getting on with that in due course. Next, I'd like to inform the board that we have looked at the Commission on Race and Ethnic Disparities report, which was published on the 31st of March. We considered the report and its findings carefully, and I would like to reinforce that our HEE plans to improve race equality within our organisation, because we have identified that we have got quite a lot of work to do within HEE, and also we already have plans with the wider NHS and our other stakeholders and partners to look at improving race equality in the work that we influence and in our partnerships. So I would just like to reinforce that we will continue on that work programme within HEE. We had some conversation earlier about data from the our data warehouse from the audit committee. So timely for me to let the board know about the Data Alliance Partnership Charter for Health and Adult Social Care Data. So on the 22nd of September of last year, Secretary of State for Health and Social Care convened a roundtable and secured buy-in for a data alliance partnership under the leadership of NHSX. And the idea was to oversee work to reduce the burden on the front line and allow more effective sharing of data across health and social care. So the Alliance Partnership Board first met on the 28th of October, set out some principles of the partnership for health and adult social care. So this charter we signs HEE along with the DHSC and other ALBs to a set of principles that we move towards reducing the burden of data requests. And of course, we need to make sure that this complies and works to our own governance arrangements within HEE. But we see this as a really positive step in tackling some thorny issues between all of our organisations across health and care and ALBs for the improvement for our population. So we can keep you informed again of progress. Next, I'd like to move on to open consultations. There are two for the board to note. The first is a consultation by the Nursing and Midwifery Council on draft standards for community and public health nursing. And if there are any questions, I would invite Mark to give us more detail. But we are engaging with that consultation. And the second is on the regulating healthcare professionals and protecting the public, which is being led by the Department of Health and Social Care. And it's with regards to proposals for reform and modernization of the regulation of healthcare professionals. Again, plans are being tested with key stakeholders, and we are obviously a key stakeholder as HEE. And again, I will invite Wendy and other colleagues to take any questions. And then just to let the board know, we have been working together with the leaders within HEE in our newly renamed Leaders Network, and doing some really, I'm really impressed by the openness and willingness to engage in looking at values and behaviours within our organisation to enable us to be properly productive and deliver on our outcomes. Liz already mentioned I joined the Patient Advisory Forum or People Advisory Forum meeting in April, and it was a very lively meeting, and really keen to engage further. And our digital task and finish group has met for the second meeting, and we've got quite a lot to get on with there. Thank you, Sir David.
Thanks, Navina. So let's open up for questions, comments on Navina's report, please. Soraya, please.
Sorry, Sir David, my computer's a bit slow this morning. Thank you, Navina, for the report. Just, I'd be interested to just hear a little bit more about the operating framework and our engagement externally with the external focus, in particular with HEIs and other education providers.
Shall I...
Go for it.
I am actually going to do my usual trick of handing over to David Farrelly, who is leading on this work, to address that question, please. David?
Thanks, Amina. Yes, there's two parts of developing the operating model. There's the internal work to make sure that we're connected better, and we're looking at the future role of regions within the context of ICS development. So the programme oversight board that was setting up internally is looking at that. But we have very strong connections with ENI. So there's a joint oversight group, which myself, Patrick Mitchell, Rob Smith sit on with our counterparts in NHS ENI to make sure that we're connecting with the ICS oversight framework, with the emerging ICS level operating model. So that's trying to split what elements of workforce should be done at a national, regional system and place level. So we're engaged with that. There's several subgroups across NHS ENI looking at each of these different elements, because one of the challenges for us is we need to look at it from a pathway point of view, a programme point of view, as well as a place point of view. So we've got to have three lenses on it. So our challenge at the moment is trying to make sure that we have a regional director buddy from HE on each of these forums, so that we're really getting a regional director and HE response into all of the emerging work. and that includes some of the national work with NHS E&I on the overarching operating model, not just the people directorate way of working and operating model. With the regions, what we've done in terms of HEI, all the regions now have HEI sort of regular meetings, so they meet bi-monthly with all of the deans, etc., from universities to make sure both we're delivering on our MTIP requirements, but also looking at future requirements, changes to curricula, changes in terms of delivery of programmes, and any issues arising from students. So they're in place now across all the regions, and we get regular feedback from that.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, David.
Thank you, David. I just wondered with regulators, because sometimes that we are stifled in terms of the agility with which universities can actually operate. Have we got strong connections now with regulators, and are we working well with them to actually so that they become an enabler rather than a barrier?
We have, and Mark might want to jump in on this. So certainly with the NMC and the CQC, we do. And interestingly, the NMC were in touch with us about 2 weeks ago because they're changing their infrastructure because they're recognising the need for ICS influence in terms of delivery. So they've been very interested in our delivery model, how regions work, so they can think around how they feed that through their NMC arrangements as well.
That's great. Thank you, Sir David.
Mark, do you want to add to that?
Just a quick point to say the regional work in terms of the delivery of the model is really, really quite critical. But we've put a lot of time into making sure the connections between those regional conversations link up into the policy space. And as you rightly pointed out, Soraya, how we then engage directly into the regulators themselves. And I have to say our work with the NMC and also HCPC, and I'm sure Wendy would talk with the General Medical Council and other areas, is very strong, actually. We've done a lot of work, particularly during COVID, in terms of advancing and supporting our students through the regulatory processes, but also the lessons learned. So, you know, things that both at regional level and national level, we've been considering around future preparation and support of healthcare workers into the system. And some of that leads into the points that Naveena mentioned in the board report around the consultations we've got ongoing at the moment about direction of travel in the both post-reg and pre-reg environment for nursing. So we've built a very strong and important relationship with the regulators, and particularly with Nursing Midwifery Council and HCPC. But I'm sure Wendy has views, of course, with GMC.
Wendy, briefly, please.
Yeah, thank you. So I meet with all the regulators in terms of our links with them and the quality framework. But obviously, specifically, the regulating healthcare professionals, protecting the public consultation, I think we view that as an enormous opportunity to shift the dial, partly based on what we've learned in COVID, partly based on the good relationships we've built up across the healthcare regulators. But I think that the modernisation of healthcare professional regulation will fit with the modernisation of the healthcare system regulation that CQC has been leading. I think it's a really big opportunity for us all. I think of all the regulators, the one most interested in place-based is the NMC at the moment. I think we are working with particularly the GMC on the medical reform agenda, which, as you know, has got a very strong emphasis on geography and place space. But I think that's one of the opportunities that the consultation gives us, is to say, what is it the system needs from regulators to be nimble, adaptable and flexible? And we've got really excellent bricks to build with following our experiences in COVID.
OK, thank you. Andrew Foster, please, and then I'll come to Rob Smith.
So my question, Naveena, is about the first item on your report and the feedback from the People Plan Advisory Group and the National People Board. Obviously, any national thinking about workforce strategy is tremendously important to HE. So two questions for me. One is it your sense that there is to be a new workforce strategy later on in the year, or is this simply reviewing the existing People Plan? And secondly, those two very interesting presentations you referred to, would it be possible to, from Rob and from Matthew Taylor, would it be possible to share those?
So the first question is, I think we always intended for the people plan, which was published not so long ago, to be something that was iterative and that we would build on. So whether you call that new or a refresh, so it is something that we will be building on. So that's how we want to work to, with regards to that plan. I hope that answers that question, Andrew. I think it's a really good point about sharing the presentation. Certainly, Rob's is ours, so I think we could definitely share that in that presentation. And Giles, I think we could go back and ask the team. I'm sure we could definitely share some of the thinking from there.
Thank you.
Rob, your hand was up and it's gone down again. Are you shy today, or have you?
No, I was going to talk about the operate model, but actually Andrew's given me a segue. The presentation to the NPB was really to try and frame what workforce planning is, and similar to the work we've shared with the board previously. And it's nice to hear some of the phrases being used, because this is about how we deploy all levers at all levels to get the effect. And one of the key things is about true subsidiarity, which is that we need the operate model to work at each level. Now, we're working with Stephen Eames and the group on the ICS model, but the question about regulators is clearly about how does the national model work, and working with Gavin and colleagues at the department to make sure that that's coherent too, and that they're then coherent with each other. And that's the kind of challenge we've given ourselves. And of course, they're interlinked, aren't they? Because local HEIs are dependent on the regulatory system within which they work to serve their local community. So that's why we're so keen to get that true subsidiarity right, rather than it becoming a kind of binary, a local national kind of discussion.
Very good. I think this is such important work, colleagues. John Latham, please.
Yeah, sorry, this is just to pick up on the comments Soraya made, really, around sort of regional interaction and stakeholder management and that kind of thing. So, and I know, David, you're following up the suggestion we had to get Steve West, who's going to be the new president of UUK, to come and talk to the board. One of the other things I was talking to my East of England buddy about was, how do they, on a regional basis, talk to their universities? And another thing I've suggested to Steve is that maybe UUK hosts regional VC dinners with the regional lead, and maybe if Mark or others wanted to join, but basically to raise the profile of health with the, you know, the VCs regionally. Because again, I do have this concern that quite often we're going through deans of health, which is great, but actually the overall universities have got big strategies on at the moment. We need to raise the profile, I think, certainly with some VCs, of the importance of the health provision and the opportunities that are there. So I think that sort of stakeholder management is quite key over the next couple of years.
John, I think that is so important. And Naveen, I wonder whether we could work out how we can pursue John's point. I've been fortunate to spend some time in the Southwest. It's just absolute coincidence. I've done UWE, Plymouth and Exeter universities with a mixture of Liz and Liz Hughes and for the new medical schools. And what is absolutely clear to me, John, just to make your point, is how mathematics, engineering and other sciences are actually informing what's going on in some schools of health, whether that's Patrick Mitchell's team have just been doing some work on the future workforce in things like data. So for data analytics, the use of AI, et cetera, hugely, hugely important. So we should pursue that. Naveena, sorry, I think I talked over you.
I interrupted you. So I mean, that as you were speaking then, John, I was thinking that's such a helpful piece of advice or challenge, and important that we go back and look with our regional directors and our regional postgraduate deans and everybody else, how are we, just do a quick assessment of how well connected are we with the VCs in the different regions. I suspect it probably is historical and relationships and all of that, but where we need to strengthen and where we need to build upon. So that is definitely a piece of work that we will pursue. Thank you.
Yeah, I obviously sit on the board for the West Midland VCs. I've been on that board now for 7 years. I can't remember health being on its agenda, if I'm being honest.
I was really impressed by just how connected Debbie Riley, our regional director in the Southwest, was with the universities in the Southwest. It was very clear, just spending some time with three of those VCs, just how connected Debbie was. But Andrew George, if we'll make this the last one on this item, please.
So, sorry, I just wanted to build on John's, and I totally agree with that one, but we have got to think about how to make the landscape simpler for the VCs. I was speaking to one president of a university the other day, and she just, I just can't be asked, basically. It's too complex. All of these acronyms, all of these different people, you know, engineering straightforward. And so we've got to, we've got to make it simple for... And we've got to make it look like we're not 21 of 25 people who are all going to take a bite of them, and they're going to have to work out how to deal with all 25 in order to progress.
I gave it some on... I feed it once a week.
There's a challenge. I don't know who's feeding what once a week, but if you could go on mute, that would be really helpful. I hope that's not the children, but anyway. Just ask, the two consultation documents, are we going to formally respond?
Sorry, yes.
And yes. Therefore, yes. When that response goes in, I'm sure that I'm not alone as non-executive directors. If they could be copied to us as they go into the consultation bodies, and then we can just complete the circle on this. It's right to raise it now, but it'd be also nice to ensure that we can get the results of the consultation. And if I invite any non-executive directors, if they want to make comments on these documents, to feed that into the exec team so it can inform the comments as well. For my part, I'm confident the exec will go back and do that, so I'm not looking to do that, but I would like to see the results of the comments that we send in. The strategic importance of both of these consultation documents shouldn't be underestimated, quite frankly. So thank you for that. So I think that now brings us on to operational delivery and assurance is the heading for this section of our agenda. And I think, Callum, you were going to present the report on finance, which is a report that we've seen before, but significant progress has been made since the last meeting. So over to you, and you're allowed to polish your halo, I think, Callum. So.
Thank you, Sir David. I'm not sure about halos, but I think I'm not sure you have seen this report before, but it probably looks very familiar simply because the headlines are essentially the same that we've been reporting for many months now. Obviously, we're drawing to the end of in terms of reporting the last financial year. This is at month 11. And it's been obviously a year that's been very much driven by the impact of COVID, and you essentially see that in the headlines. So the continuation of a significant clinical training underspend, offset somewhat by pressures in particularly postgraduate medical and dental in relation to GP training, which is very much on a successful upward trajectory. So, and those are the main headlines. The undergraduate medical, pretty much where we would expect it to be. Some underspends in running costs, as you would expect from the fact that there's been very little travel and subdued expenditure as a result of COVID. So, and those are really what we have been reporting for a while. They continue. There's some obviously updates to the absolute numbers here, but it's the same narrative, and there's not much more to say. So I'll keep this really short. I'm really happy to take any questions anyone has on that.
Thanks, Callum. So, any questions, comments from colleagues? As Callum says, we've seen it before, and the numbers haven't moved about from significantly from one month to the next. So I think we've scrutinised this. Andrew George, yes, please.
So I guess...
gone on mute, Andrew.
Teams is not loving me at the moment. That £50 million that we've got rather at the last moment, which has obviously slightly made things look less neat in some ways. We obviously didn't know that was coming, so we couldn't foresee that.
That's correct, Andrew. It's essentially really going to be a bookkeeping adjustment that will come in month 12. It doesn't really affect anything. It was never planned for. Obviously, month 12, we can't spend it. So it's just really just a highlight that will then that will be the one remaining change between month 11 and month 12. We expect to see in the final results for the year, which we will come to obviously when we report the annual report and financial statements.
Anyone? I wasn't going to comment on it. It's one of the rare occasions in my whole lifetime when we've been given additional money and it's not been any use. So it's just one of the intrigues of life, I think. But are we content to move on? Okay. Callum and team, thank you very much for that. So that takes us to... Section 8 on the agenda, which is business planning, and again, of documents we've seen before, here's the business plan, which has been worked up. Lee, are you going to lead us on this one?
I am, David. I'm not going to take long, I'm just going to sort of point out the changes from previous versions so people are aware of what has changed. Just to reiterate that we're not publishing this until after Purdah is finished for the local elections and the mayoral elections and etc. So it won't be published until after the 7th of May, even though we're discussing it here today. As David said, it's been to the board in various forms, once as to show the process we were going to undertake and once in draft version last time. I'll just take you through it very quickly, show the changes since the draft version, so you're very clear what's changed. First of all, we've given it a name, which is a recovery and delivery, which shows what we're trying to do. We have called it a section 3 HE priorities, which, as Keith puts in the chat, reflects the fact we don't have a mandate yet. But we have broadly seen a draft of it and we're pretty comfortable with it. And so we're expecting it to look a lot like what's in the priority section, but obviously it's not published yet. But we're confident that it will be soon. And I know meetings are happening with NHS E&I in the coming period to follow that process through. At the bottom of page 6, you will see that we've put in some numbers around the METIP, so a bit of a summary of them, which gives you an idea of the sort of money we spend and where we spend it before we get into the detail that's in the attached document. The plan on the page on page 4, slightly going backwards, reflects everything that's in the business plan, leading from our values at the bottom all the way up to the purpose we signed off last year, with value for money running all the way through it. We've finalised our ambitious, more ambitious goals. So at the bottom, top of page 7, the board wanted us to be a bit more ambitious in our goals, so we have there. In objectives, we've added some words around AHP growth to reflect the fact that it's not just nurses, it's AHPs as well who will be part of building the future. So that's in under the first objective under future workforce. We've also added a new objective which reflects part of the conversation we've just had around at the top of page 12 around how we're going to support the system in the development of ICSs and work with NHS I&E around operating model as well as our own internal operating model. So that's now in there as an objective. We've added a section on regional priorities to show how they're going to work with local colleagues to further their ambitions locally as well as our collective ambitions. There is, thankfully, which I know we'll come to later, so I won't dwell on it, a budget. So how we use our money is a section. Under page 15 onwards, with some helpful graphs, as well as a bit of a summary before the graphs. And then there is a section on metrics, which new section on metrics, which reflects the process the board signed off originally, which was that we will have the metrics we currently have, we will use, but there's a process being led by David Fowley and Andrew George, and using the key business questions that we outlined last time around to make sure we really get to the nitty-gritty of what we want to measure, and we measure things that we actually need to measure rather than things that are easy to measure, which is what the NHS often does. On that basis, I'm hoping people don't see anything new and different that they didn't expect from last time. I think it's still a sharp, tight document. I think it reflects what we want to do for the year. I think for the first time it does link very clearly to our business as usual work. The METIP work is in there, front and centre. And the comms and engagement plan that will come with it is just being finalised at the moment, because obviously we're not publishing until after the 7th of May, so we haven't circulated that yet, but we'll be doing that in the next few days.
Lee, thank you, and thanks for just walking us through the developments since the last time we saw this in the way that you just have. So, again, this is something that I think this is the third time we've seen this now in its various incarnations at the board. So I'm not really looking for lots of comments and discussions on this. I hope we can just move to agree, if we may. That said, I don't want to stop any comments coming through. So it's just trying to strike the balance. Liz, you're showing your hand, yeah. So over to you.
Yeah. But yes, I thought it was a really good document, consistent with what we've talked about before and fleshed out quite a bit of the detail. My only question was on the plan on a page. So audit committee yesterday, we talked a little bit about accessibility standards for people accessing documents and said that diagrams like that aren't really brilliant. So it was more a strategic question about will that be easy to understand for all audiences?
Yeah, that's really helpful. Thanks for that, Liz. Our plan this year is to publish a version like this, but also publish a web-enabled version that will be completely accessible to web readers. They'll be able to, it will be shown not in that sort of diagram, but in a different format that will make it accessible online.
Yeah, brilliant. Thanks, Lee. Thanks.
Anybody else? Are we content to agree this? I think. Are we also agreeing the acronym? I should be using the acronym, but METIP that is here as well. Are we technically doing two things? I don't think we agreed this when it came to our last meeting. So given this has elements where it stands alone, I'm just asking for some guidance from Nicola and Navina. My instinct is to invite the board to agree the METIP as well as a business plan. Mm.
Yeah,
okay. All right, so can I, with Lizzie's important point and Lee, your response, can I invite the board to agree the Health Education England business plan for the financial year 21-22 and also agree the METIP for 21-22 as well. Yeah. Okay. Can I just say thank you to Lee, Neil, and your team. The danger of mentioning names is you leave somebody out. So, but I think the way that this has evolved over the period from January into this final format, I think speaks well of the work that has been undertaken, Lee, by you and your team. I think, you know, because I see some of the stuff going on in the background, I think Neil's eye for detail and attention to detail and the ability to cross-reference this to a whole bunch of other documents helps immeasurably, as does a greater push towards plain English. We've still got one or two acronyms lingering around in there, but personally, I think it reads very, very well. And the developments you've just taken us through of making transparent our regional activity, the continuing work on data and evaluation, et cetera, I think are all designed to further improve and develop this piece of work. So, Lee, big thank you on behalf of the board. And I don't know whether Neil's on the call, but if you could just pass on to your team the appreciation of the board for the work that is demonstrated by this plan.
I will make sure everybody knows. Thank you, David.
Okay, thanks. So, I think that then takes us to... just make sure I've not scribbled any comments anyway. Yeah, that's it. Apologies for that, guys. So if I could go on to item 8.2, which is budget setting. And Callum, this is the results of a fair amount of work on your behalf and your senior team on pulling this budget together. So over to you to present.
Thank you, David. Essentially, this is reflected in the business plan that you have just seen, I think page 16, and essentially reflects the key headlines that are set out there. And it's, we've obviously reached I think a really good settlement under difficult conditions this year in terms of funding for HEE, and that's been very much done with working trilaterally with the Department of Health and Social Care and NHS England, and that enables us to set budgets that enable us to not only fund the continuation of training that's going on, but also enable us to move ahead with some really important developments in terms of supporting the long-term plan. And the work we've done with the importance of doing that work with NHS England and the Department of Health means that all the parties involved have looked at the various risks and priorities of where money should be allocated and ensured that it reaches the best balance available. And we're really appreciative that there are some, quite significant increases within this. Just our ongoing training activity, the activity we've already started has requires a lot of additional funding in the year ahead as numbers grow year on year, additional cohorts come into play. So very particular, the two main ones to point out, of course, the growth in the number of GP trainees, which is a really key plank behind the long-term plan. And of course, the need to grow clinical numbers, and particularly the 50,000 target for nursing, which we are in some ways in a lucky position that the market is working in our favour. A lot of additional recruitment during the year we've just come out of, the 2021 year, and we see that trend continuing. So more people going to university to go on those courses means more placement funding required from us. And all of that is honoured within this plan. And we've also gone through a business planning process that has shared these plans with each of our seven regional directors and our national directors to ensure that their local priorities, the areas they need to invest in from discussions with their regional people boards and their ICS contacts, are also reflected in this. And they have also been very much involved in this and have effectively signed these off as well. So so the activity is there with some really good increases as well in areas such as mental health and cancer, again, towards the long-term plan. We do see a reduction in the what essentially our brought forward position on workforce development of 50 million, which was reduced. You'll see that in on page 10. But it is worth just commenting, whilst that seems negative, that was something that had to be agreed to make this budget affordable, and was agreed with NHS England and the Department of Health, and was just one of the compromises we had to go through. However, I think it's well worth noting that the headline total for workforce development should actually be should land pretty much where it was last year, because some of the new areas of funding, so cancer, mental health, etc., some elements of that will actually contribute towards workforce development. So we expect the headline to be very much around the same level as it was this year, perhaps just with redirected. I think in terms of other headlines, it's really important to note that we've allowed an additional 18 million for the CPD fund that was initiated last year, which is really great to be able to communicate that basically reflects the growth in the numbers of the workforce. So the fund available to support that needs to grow. So that is factored in as well. So I think those are probably the key sort of activity changes that sit behind this budget, and how we've got to them and how we've assured that they match what needs to happen on the ground. I think it's worth just commenting on the funding assumption behind this as well. Whilst tariff rates have yet to be published, the assumption behind this is that we will honour salary uplifts so that we don't end up transferring costs to the service. So that's, I think that's good news. Tariff, we do expect tariff rates to be, the training tariff rates to be held pretty much flat, and we've got that's reflected in the MeetIt paper that's just above this item on the agenda. So I think those are probably the key points in terms of the activity and the rates we're paying that we've used here. We still, I should just point out, there probably will be a very minor change around the admin funding. Had a notification post this paper being finalised from the Department of Health, which just clarified an area, which means actually there should be just a little bit more available for admin, which means we will be essentially reducing our admin by 2% rather than the 3 million set out here. But we, as I say, I think that's relatively minor, doesn't affect this, and we will need to find probably just a compensating amount within program to save, so the whole thing balances. But that's really a small change, just for the record. So yeah, I'm very happy to take any questions around this.
Thank you, Callum. So let me open it up briefly for questions or comments. No, we've seen it before, and we feel briefed and engaged and supportive. So thank you. Callum, let me just congratulate you and your team, Naveena as well. I think it's hugely significant this was worked out on a trilateral basis, and I know Keith Wright's on this board call, but I'd also want to pay tribute to senior colleagues in the Department of Health, David Williams, who's now moved to be Permanent Secretary at Ministry of Defence, and Lee McDonough, who have both, in my view, been massively influential in ensuring that the proposals from HEE have been scrutinised, and after that scrutiny were then supported. And I'd also want to recognise the role that Julian Kelly and Matthew Stiles have played from NHS England, NHS Improvement. And Callum, I think you working with DH and NHSEI senior colleagues has really been why we're able to sit here today and finalise and agree the budget we're we've got the full amount we were asking for to deliver the uprate in the base budget, the complete resources for the manifesto commitments, as well as some of the people plan delivery of the long-term plan ambitions. And I think that's a tremendous achievement that you've secured for the organisation. And the benefit of that will be in those increased number of learners that will be able to go through and then enter the workforce in the longer term. So I just want to put on record our appreciation of the work of DH and I&E colleagues, but also pay tribute to you and your team. I know you've got a number of people that have worked with you that have supported you. And a bit like Lee, I'm sure I speak on behalf of the board in inviting you to pass on our thanks and appreciation to all your team for the work that they've done to deliver this budget. So a big, big well done, I think, from the board, Callum, to you and your colleagues. So and thank you for the helpful tutorial in simple arithmetic in relation to how you get to £5 billion, which I just couldn't make it work, but I'll leave everybody else to work that out. Clearly everybody else had worked it out, it's just me. Right, let's move on to the COVID recovery plan. You've got papers here, and I think, Wendy, you're going to lead us through this. And I think we've got about 10 minutes for this conversation. So thank you.
Thank you, Sir David. I'm going to be brief, as we've had the opportunity to discuss this as it's emerged over many months. So this is, if you like, where are we at this moment in time? And just to remind colleagues on the board that as of this time last year, we were mobilising doctors in training into the front line of the COVID service. And at any one time, up to 50% of these people were redeployed. And that means actually formally moving from their specialty of choice to a new way of working. And indeed, many of them were in completely different clinical teams. We'll be focusing a little bit on the feedback that we had from them, which we've shared with you and the board before. But for many, it was a positive experience with a lot more support, because there were a lot of consultants present. No routine service work was happening, so there was a complete focus on what they were doing. However, all training was suspended. We also released, and it's important to remember this, because we released our trainers back into the system. And that included some of our postgraduate deans who went into frontline work, as well as our trainers on the ground who were back in the clinical world full time. The ebb and flow of that activity was such that by August of last year, we had managed to do a full round of recruitment, digitally enabled and remote. We had done a full round of annual assessments, again, remote and digitally enabled. And we had encouraged and worked really closely with the regulator, the GMC, for what we've now called derogations, which are flexibilities in the regulatory requirements for training, with huge support from the GMC and particularly working closely with the devolved administrations, because as you will remember, postgraduate medicine is a four-country effort in terms of the regulatory framework. But also working very closely with our regional directors, regional postgraduate deans, as the surge impact was felt differently across the country. However, the impact of the second or third wave, depending on where you live and what you want to call it, in the autumn, has significantly impacted the progress of trainees. We now know, from the evidence we've got from ARCPs, from the further derogations, that simply catching up within program time is not going to be possible. Even if we maximise all of the modern technology around simulation, new ways of working and new ways of assessment. So we have started a formal program called the COVID-19 Postgraduate Medical Training Recovery Plan. And we're co-producing this program with our colleagues in the Department of Health, our colleagues across the system, so NHS England, obviously, GMC, all of the colleges and all of our stakeholder groups, ranging from the BMA Junior Doctors Group to the Academy Junior Doctors Group, and all of our regional groups as well. We are now at the stage where we do not believe that all trainees need an extension of their training. And that's because we've been talking to our doctors in training. We know that everyone's been affected, even if they weren't formally redeployed, because the NHS did not function as it normally does. So the access to training material was very different. So what we've done is we've looked at this program in three phases, and they are interlinked and overlapping phases. There will be no distinct end to one, and I'll explain why in a moment. So stage one, which is where we are now, is the reset work. And this is about getting our processes back on track, continuing to do the things that really matter to trainees, getting them recruited, getting them into the post, getting their assessments done. And then actually looking at the individual needs for trainees as to what they will need to get through the system. We are focusing that on maintaining the supply line, which means maintaining entry at recruitment, at core and higher, and exit at the end of training periods. Just to go back to Callum's last comments about the expansion in general practice, if we do not maintain the output in general practice, we simply cannot accommodate the significant increase in recruitment. We've increased recruitment because that's part of our mandate requirements to deliver the 6,000 extra GPs that the manifesto has stated it needs. So we need to keep the pipeline going. There isn't endless training capacity. And I'm really pleased to say that the first set of recruitment data that we've got, which is the core level, which includes general practice, our five-year average is that we recruit to around 7,400 posts. This year, we've recruited to 7,782 posts. That's 105.2% for those of you that want to think in that way. And general practice has gone up to 3,753 acceptances over last year's acceptances at this stage of 3,269. So we are doing what we said is our core responsibility, keeping the pipeline going, increasing the number of doctors in training for the future service needs. The impact of that is how we manage the trainees that need either more time or more intensive training. And that's the work that Shona McLeod and the team are leading. And this is about how we address competencies that have either been lost because they haven't been done over the last year. We do need to keep things going, competencies that they haven't been able to access because the training hasn't existed, or indeed the confidence of trainees and the confidence and capability that goes with moving to the next stage of your career. That's really important and, of course, extremely difficult to measure, which is why the individualized nature of the recovery phase between now and next year is vital, where we actually listen to what trainees want, but also what they feel and what their trainers can deliver. Hugely important that this is done at regional and local level. So what we're doing is setting the framework with the colleges and the GMC around this. We've got an agreement with the GMC that the derogations will be continued, which again is very helpful and reassuring for trainees that they won't get into trouble, that this isn't something that they have to pay a price for. That language we've heard from our interactions with trainees, and we don't want that to be the way they feel. We're also looking to measure the competencies that people have gained during COVID. Many of them played significant leadership roles, let alone clinical roles. And we need to find a way of recognising that and building that into their confidence and professional identity. It's hugely important. Likewise, we do need to recognise that for some trainees, where they were not involved in COVID work, there's a sense of disassociation and not having been valued. And we need to balance that out because everybody has been affected. That's the real message for the board. We obviously have a duty in terms of value for money and public accountability. And working really closely with Callum and Jenny and the finance team, we are going to map the costs that we will need to meet the COVID recovery phase. We're working very closely with our department colleagues so that we actually understand what that means. But key to this is the relationship we have with NHS England and with providers. And that relationship is both at national, regional and local level. So the flexibilities we have already built into medical training that the board has heard over the past few years, you know, stepping out and stepping into training, flexible training, working less than full time, accessing new ways of assessment through simulation. We now have got that approved by the GMC in one of the very large curricula. Those are all things that we're building on. So I want to reassure the board that we're not starting from zero with this programme. This is building not only on our relations that we have established over years, but on the work that we've tested and proved that will be effective for training. And then, of course, the importance of all of this is what have we learnt and how do we pull that learning at scale and pace into a new approach to medical education and training. So that's the reform agenda. And much of this around flexibility, population health, resilience, trainee wellbeing, all of those themes that are in our reform programme, which we've shared at the board, are underpinned by the learning from COVID. And we feel that we can go faster and do more because we will be building this on a recovery programme following the pandemic. Each of the elements of this programme is led by different colleagues across the postgraduate dean spectrum, working with regional directors. So we've got quite a distributed leadership team working on this. I'm very grateful to the clinical fellows, a couple of whom are here today, because they are our canaries. We test out these ideas with them. And we have at the moment a weekly assurance group with all stakeholders meeting under Shona's chairmanship. So we are really tied into the system over this. We are convening and leading, but we have to listen and respond to both individual trainees and I think increasingly regional variations. And the key to this is making sure that all of the service planning and recovery planning that's happening recognises the need for education and training, not just for the future workforce, but for the existing training workforce. So I'll pause there, David, and take any questions.
I'm not really going to open it up in terms of time, actually, but briefly, questions, comments. We have seen this before. We took it in private session, and this is, I think, exactly the same material brought back. But if there are any burning questions from the board, then please. Soraya.
Thank you, Sir David. Wendy, thank you for a really comprehensive paper. And I think if I look at the risk section, the restart with the waiting time lists really need to keep an eye on the impact on trainees as well as our trainers. And I just wondered in terms of our mechanism, how that's going to be reported. Sorry about that. That's my doorbell just gone. How is that going to be reported through? Some of it presumably through ARC, but some through the People Forum, just to get a sense of that. Thanks, Sir David.
OK, let's store them up. John Levin, please.
Yes, it's just a quickie, really, and it's just to sort of remind people that what we are finding as well around sort of health provision in the HE sector is it's really buoyant at the moment, so we're doing really, really well. But if we think of it long term, you know, COVID recovery is recovery for the long term future. But what we are seeing is, you know, there's an underpinning massive reduction through Brexit of long-term European recruitment. And at the moment, we're riding the big wave of people in the UK primarily who want to come into the system. So as long as we are always cognizant that this is both a recovery from COVID, but we need to make sure that whatever we put in place has got longevity built into it. And there are some underlying risks, which were in that NHS report I was talking about earlier, that we're facing generally, that COVID might be hiding. So it's just making sure we're not being slightly too buoyant, shall we say, around our opportunity to respond.
It's an important point. Andrew George, please.
Very supportive of this. This looks excellent. Can I just ask about the academics in training? That's clearly a shared responsibility in NIHR, charities, etc. And they are also going to be stepping through complex systems that need help. Thank you.
OK, thanks, Andrew. Wendy?
Yeah, thank you. In terms of access to service, we are really well tied in with both the independent sector. One of our postgraduate students has done a big piece of work making sure that we have a contractual agreement with them to train, which is the first time we've ever had that. And we are working very closely with our regional teams on the reset of service agenda. I have to say, I think having trainees in that is an advantage. It's not going to slow things down. It's actually going to get through more work. And I think the regional teams are doing really well. They are reporting significant engagement. So, Soraya, we're watching it carefully. We've set up quite a complex data returns that the deans are working through so we can simplify it and it's visible to all. So we will watch that specialty by specialty, grade by grade, region by region. So a number of ways we can cut that data as it comes through. I absolutely agree, John Latham, that this is not a short plan. This is 2 to 3 year plan in our heads in terms of COVID recovery, because we have a competency-based system. And this is a real opportunity for us to shift away from the annual progression, because everybody moves in August. We have tried so hard, many of us over years, to get away from that. This is an opportunity to really do what trainees want, which is individualize, and to really build on good pedagogic practice of competency and capability rather than time served. With the risk of not understanding the supply lines, what we've seen this year, I think you're absolutely right, won't be the same as next year and the year after, because, of course, we have more applicants in the pool for training than ever before because no one's going away. I don't think we should look at that as necessarily a positive or a negative, but we can build on that learning. One piece of work that we are doing is working closely with Jed Byrne and the global team and colleagues, in particularly in primary care, about what we offer to international medical graduates so that they then can enter successfully into our postgraduate training programs, which are world respected. And that is a pool of doctors that I don't think we've done enough for. And they do prop up the NHS in early level training, core level posts, if you like. Callum has secured funds for us to test out some of the support that's been successful in specific specialties, the WASP widening access specialty training program, for example. And we are going to look at a significant expansion of that as part of both the medical reform program, but also in terms of increasing the pool for the pipeline to pull out of. And I think that's really important for us in the future. And Andrew, academics in training, we've had some really interesting conversations with Chris Whitty and NAHR colleagues around this. And the challenge is, at the moment, not on the access to clinical training, because we'll work our way through that. It is the access to particular laboratory-based academic training, which has been slow to get back to normal. We will be looking at that in more detail. Again, I think it is an opportunity for us to work with Chris Whitty and academic leaders to think about the future of academic training for doctors, rather than just simply try and prop this end up and get people back to normal. I think this is an opportunity that we see that we might want to do something broader and more in depth over the course of the next year.
Okay, Wendy, thank you. Andrew George, I think your hand is, I think that's a legacy hand, I think, but Andrew Foster, if you would, and then Rhys and Vidush, I'll give you an opportunity just to share a sentence from your perspective as a fellows, and then Shauna, I'll give you the last word on this as the SRO. So Andrew Foster, please.
Thanks, David. Yes. Following our earlier discussion about this, I took the opportunity to just have a chat about it with a couple of local directors of medical education, and the response I got was incredibly supportive and encouraging and enthusiastic about this piece of work and how much it needed doing. I did get asked one question which I couldn't answer, though, which was they could see all the emphasis on supporting trainees to get themselves into the right shape following what they've been through during COVID. The question was, is there a part of the plan which is to support trainers as well, recognising the load that we are putting onto them to help with this recovery? So I just thought I'd ask that.
Oh, good question. Wendy, do you want to take that and then I'll come to others?
That's absolutely key to this, Andrew, as you know. And it's one of the reasons why our partners in this NHS England were absolutely engaging with Steve Powers and Sealingham Clark on what can be done to support the consultant workforce, who by and large are our trainers. It's hugely important. And we've recognised that by not insisting that, for example, all of the training reviews are done by the training programme director. They simply won't have that capacity and they'll need to recover. And we rely on our regional postgraduate deans and their local schools of training to make sure that those trainers have the explicit support and time to do this. But we have to get support from NHS England colleagues, and that's why Sealingham Clark is a member of our assurance board, and I speak regularly with Steve Powers about how important it is to send the right messages to the consultant body.
And as this is a meeting that's in public today and these papers are now available for people, I think your question, Andrew, and your answer, Wendy, is a helpful addition to making that public. But Rhys, a sentence or two.
Thank you, Sir David. And thank you, Wendy and Shona, for including us in this important piece of work. I think as a starting point, from a trainee perspective, reset and recovery is the key to ensuring well-being is maintained going forward. And from my perspective, I think it's been exceptionally warming to see how a trainee has been viewed as an important stakeholder in all these discussions and soundboarding ideas with them to ensure that we really do get this right. So I'm very hopeful for this programme, and I think that it will land very well with trainees going forward.
Thanks, Rhys. Vidushi.
Thank you, Sir David, Wendy and Shona. I guess for my trainee hat on, the individual and personalised approach to this feels really feels like the right approach, and I'm really reassured by that when involved in the discussions. And with a fellow hat on, getting some insight into this work, and as Ray said, like that value kind of perspective, I think the culture shift of really ensuring training and recovery is embedded in service recovery is where the efforts really need to be, and I think where a lot of the team are focusing. So it's a pleasure and privilege really to be a part of the programme, so thank you.
And Shona, you're the SRO, do you want to have the last word on this?
I can have a very brief word. I suppose I just want to highlight that it is a very complex system we're working in. There's a number of different leaders with influence in the space, and the solutions that we're finding are all interconnected. And it is essential that the work that we do in this interdigitates with what people are trying to do on recovery. And the thing that is most encouraging is that everyone hears and acknowledges the need to integrate training and education of the future workforce. So it feels a very positive space to be inviting others in to have the conversation with us. We have very positive engagement. We just need to keep reminding them when they leave the room to continue thinking. But that's a key part of the communication element of the strategy.
Well, that's why I wanted the SRO to speak. Delivery, 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 I think, is the focus on this as we go forward. But Wendy, Shona, Rhys, Vidushi, really good papers. And it's really good to get Andrew Foster's feedback from this having been tested, that the support that there is for it. So really very, very well done. This is a great piece of work, so thank you for that. Callum, can I just check that the budget that we've just agreed will need to be supplemented by what the cost of this programme is? We've not agreed the money for this reset and recovery for postgraduate medical education.
We certainly haven't got it all in place. I think it's probably the message. Okay. So, yeah, you know, we've got significant, you know, we have got significant costs that will arise as a result of COVID, but we're in a good place in terms of discussing that with both the Department of Health, NHS England and the Treasury. So it's just something that we need to be really focused on over the next 2 or 3 months.
Yeah, okay, brilliant. Just I thought that was the case, and I just wanted to tease that out just to make it clear for non-executive colleagues. We're not viewing it as a problem, but it's just in the interest of clarity. So well done, everybody. So let's move on. Item 8 is the People's Advisory Forum, and Phil, I've seen your picture crop up on the screen, so a big welcome to you. But let me hand over to Liz. I think you're going to walk us through this item.
Yeah, Liz. Thanks, Sir David. And as you said, welcome, Phil. As we said earlier, Phil's the new co-chair of the People's Advisory Forum. We've got a short report for you in the format of 6 slides. I'm going to go through the first couple. Then Mark, who's SRO for PATH, will go through the slides 3 and 4. And Phil's going to finish us off with the final 2 slides, and then we'll be open to questions. So we just want to highlight the work that PATH's doing. And I think this is going to be a biannual report to the board. So you'll see Phil there. If you can't see his photo on your screen, Phil is the person second from the left on the screen. And Phil was volunteered by his co-PATH members to be the co-chair. And it's really great to have a co-chair, because this is about involvement, making sure that we get views coming forward. So it felt really important for myself as chair to have someone from the group fulfilling that role and really working with members to get their opinions so that we can be cognizant of all views for HE's processes. So next slide, please, Nick. Thank you. So PATH is about... Can I do it? I don't know if I can. It is in the pack. So the slides are in the pack. So shall I just run through them? And if we can move them on, we will do. So the name of Patient Advisory Forum was changed to People's Advisory Forum because this is about capturing the views of patients, but also of carers. We have a trainee on there, and the public, to make sure that we are involving people as much as we can, and that people's views are integral to HE decision making. So we meet 4 times a year as a whole group, but PATH members are really prolific behind the scenes at attending key meetings and policy forums for HE to give the view of the public into that. So I'm on next slide now, Nick, sorry. And throughout the presentation, you'll see we've got some quotes from PATH members. So Priscilla is one of our really active PATH members who shares her experiences and comments in some of our forums. So how do we agree the membership? So members are initially appointed for 3 years, but we have had some members who have served for a further 3-year term. The members are made up from across England, so we've got a geographical spread and a different range of experiences that all go into the rich pot of comments and interventions from PATH members. Some of our members completed their terms of office, which works for some of them. They've been on PATH for a long time. They'd run for 2 terms. So we've recruited some new members, particularly thinking about diversity of the group, strengthening the voice of young people, and also sort of thinking about how we move forward with PATH. We've deliberately held off recruiting to our full complement till the end of the COVID period. And this is partly because some of the groups that PATH members will be attending have had to be put on hold. And I think it's been fairly frustrating for PATH members because of that, but we all recognise that we're in a particular place in time, and we will be doing some recruitment following a PATH development day that we're having in June. So on to the next slide, and Mark's going to take over from here.
Great, thanks, Liz and colleagues. So, I mean, first up front, I'd really like to commend Liz, Phil, who lead and chair the committee. You know, with their leadership and steer through this committee, it really has revitalised it, and particularly important because, you know, I personally know other execs and board members know from their own organisations or previous organisations how important it is to get our customer and our important feedback in relation to how we do business, and also importantly the outcomes that we're supporting out there in the community with our trainees, and importantly the health service is really quite critical. So I'm really pleased with the way the team have come together in terms of revitalising and refocusing it, and again, special commendation to Liz Fenton, who's been working directly with PATH over a number of years and helping us guide and shape this. But the shift to this being a kind of subcommittee of board, I think, is a really important signal of how we as a board take the importance of the advisory element of the People's Advisory Forum into our work. And whilst changing terms of references and all of the technical requirements in relation to a committee like this, it's actually about the people that sit on it. And we've, as Liz said, got some real diversity in thinking and development and opportunities. And it's a really great meeting. We get a lot of really rich content, lots of challenge, lots of robust challenge, actually, about how we do things and feedback. And I think that's really important for us. We present a wide range of opportunities for discussion amongst PAF, which I think is really, really important. We're always grateful for lots of input to PAF from executive, non-executive colleagues. And I know that that is really valued by PAF members in knowing what's going on in the business, about how our leadership is affecting and some of the challenges that we've had, notably through COVID, which I think has been really, really important and helpful. We'd really welcome and encourage lots of people to come to future PAF meetings, and we'll work with Liz and Phil to make sure that we get a real range of opportunities for PAF members to help contribute, and not just in relation to the PAF meeting itself, but also the business of the meeting, of the work that we do. If the next slide, please, Nick. There's a huge amount of a range of topic areas and input that go into this across a wide range of our work at Health Education England, really tapping into service user, carer and other feedback in relation to the business of our work. And like I've said, and Liz and Phil know this, that, you know, acting as critical friends and also champions of our organisation is a fundamental part of what we do. And we have some really robust challenge and feedback about aspects of our business, what we do, some of the data and the impact that we have. And that's really, really important because they bring so much expertise and knowledge into our work, which I think has been really helpful. And of course, you know, our primary focus is improving, you know, the care of our citizens across this country through education and development of the training of the workforce. And, you know, and they take those responsibilities extremely seriously and interact with lots of different aspects of our work through committees and engagement sessions. And as Liz said, you know, it's been really challenging through COVID to get that right for some of our PAF members. In fact, we had a really good discussion last time about how we can improve that to make sure they can feel more embedded in other aspects of the HE business, which we'll take forward. So lots of individuals on thing have huge amounts of experience and talents from their other areas of their work and their professional lives. And we try to tap them in to make sure that we can use that knowledge and expertise in shaping what we do. So I'd just like to say again, thank you to Liz and Phil and the wider PAF team, because without your invaluable expertise and insights, you know, we would be, you know, less rich as an organisation for being able to help shape what we do, how we do it, and the impact this has on the NHS and social care. So thank you. And I'll hand over now to Phil.
Thank you, Mark. It's a great privilege. So thank you for the support so far that I've been given and the warm welcome. It's a real, I'm not just saying, it's a real privilege to be able to present today along with Liz and Mark at my first kind of feedback to the board. I just want to touch on some of the work that the forum does, really. People have already explained that it's a huge amount of work programs that we're involved in, you know, dental, nursing, mental health. It's the full range of work that HE does. There's usually a people's advisory forum member somewhere in that. There'll be a PAF member either doing workshops or sitting alongside a programme board or a task and finish group. So it's a very rich landscape of work that we're involved in. Obviously, some things in the report to bring out, really. Really passionate, obviously, as a carer myself, that we led, the steering group was led by PAF members around the work that we did with Carers UK, which again, creating those resources for carers, which was an amazing thing to be involved in and to support. Obviously working closely alongside nursing colleagues around nursing and midwifery and understanding the kind of future of what that looks like and how we use, and people have said, as Liz and Mark have already said, actually the real power of that lived experience, experiencing firsthand delivery of care, can have a huge kind of knock-on effect to how then you develop that and grow that for the future, and the real power of that lived experience into, you know, flavouring the way that education and training is developed and grows and moves forward. Lots of involvement around the top hole. You know, we had a previous member called Elizabeth Marmero, who was very important in that kind of role of the Topple report. I'm really proud that she co-presented on the NHS Confederation main stage conference as well with Eric via the kind of video link. It was a really powerful part for certainly PAF and for HEE to show the breadth and the skills they've got in all the work that they're involved in. And obviously, you know, pre-COVID, in the days where people used to hang around in conference centres and at stalls, when we used to meet face-to-face, there was lots of involvement from PAF members, you know, with the kind of more corporate side of HE, certainly at conferences, national conferences and local events as well. Can I have the next slide, please? Just moving forward, it has been true to say that we have had a big refresh. You know, we've looked at our terms of reference in a different way. You know, I think to say that we've had a name change from patients to people, I think meant lots more as well. It meant about actually what are we as a community, you know, how are we not just interfacing as patients, but actually, you know, as carers, as family members, as members of the public, and how we use that kind of broader kind of system, really. We had a recruitment campaign year before last, and that was really successful. We were lucky to recruit some really kind of passionate new members onto PAF, with very different experiences. People always said, you know, we have trainees involved in that now. We have people with different experiences, and I think that's really enriched the kind of skill set that PAF have got moving forward. It was really good. Our last PAF meeting, we were challenged to be more ambitious, and I think we really want to do that. You know, we really want to be that group of individuals that can support HEE moving forward, using our lived experience, using our skills, using our kind of networks and knowledge that we all bring as individuals into that kind of forum. And I think it's really exciting times. We need to look at recruitment. We also need to have this kind of development day that we've got planned. And I think we're really excited to try and kind of make PAF the machine that can deliver things, I think, for HEE, and really kind of use the power of lived experience to support the entire organisation across HEE. And I think we're really up for that challenge to be ambitious, to look at the ways of recruiting, to look at different models of recruiting, not just do the same old, same old. I think for us, it's about how we engage with people, you know, where they want to be engaged, and how we bring that collectively into PAF and then into HEE across all the various programmes. We have various things. We have subgroups around communication. So we have a dedicated PAF members working on communications and various things. We're going to be enhancing more of our kind of social kind of media networks and how we use the power of that a little bit more. So there's lots of excitement coming forward, really. And I think we're in a really, really good place. I have to say, first of all, thanks to Liz for all Liz Fenton for all the support that she gives PAF. Really, we really couldn't do what we do without her kind of connection. And likewise, Liz Mia, who's our fairly newish, I don't know how we can keep saying newish, Liz, chair. And I think her kind of new vision and new insight again has brought that refresh, and massive support from Mark. Really, I think it really is important that PAF members are still connected back into that executive team, and they feel that they are contributing to the work that they're doing. So really thanks to support from all those. And I will just thank Jocelyn as well, who's our kind of main admin lady, who keeps us all together. We are a very passionate group of individuals sometimes, and it can be like controlling very excitable cats on a very sunny day, that we all want to get outside and do things. Actually, how you kind of connect us and move us forward, I think it is sometimes a bit of magic sometimes. But I think we're all passionate, and we want to really do that support for HEE. At the end of the day, I think we know that actually using our lived experience that feeds back into training and education will deliver the best education and training, but ultimately will deliver the best care back to people like ourselves. And I think that's the kind of journey we want to go on. And I'll stop there. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thanks, Phil. And I like that analogy of like cats going out in summer. I've not heard that one before. So think about that. So has anybody got any questions?
So why don't we, Liz, why don't we open it up and let's try and have a conversation, a discussion, rather than turn it into a question and answer session. I think you've set out what you've been doing and what you intend to do. I'm sure there'll be comments from across the board. But Liz Fenton, do you just want to build the bridge from the presentation into the conversation? You've been called out for your contribution to this, which I've witnessed, and if others hadn't called you out, I would have done. So, Liz, do you want to add anything before we throw it wide open?
Thank you, Sir David. And actually, I think Phil and colleagues have articulated the work of PAF really well. I think as a group, they're our greatest champions, but also play a really great role as critical friends. And what we're wanting to do now is work with the members to how we can maximise their impact across the organisation. So would really value the thoughts and ideas from board colleagues.
OK, I think the renaming, the redefinition that you've led, Liz, is hugely important. It was really interesting. The news last week had a segment on a vaccination centre, and it spoke to two people that had been vaccinated, and it put the names up, and then it said patient. And I don't often speak to the television, but I was forced to say, but they're not a patient, they're just members of the public. What are we doing here? You know, the symbolism of the shift is hugely significant for me. I normally wait to make my points, but on this one, I'd just be interested, what's the thing that the public group is the most proud of that you've secured a change in as a result of your intervention? I think Liz Fenton's point about this is about impact is absolutely to the point. And I wouldn't mind if somebody would come back to me on that. But I've got five people signalling, and I'm sure others will come in. So I'm just going to call them in the way that they went up. So Naveena first and then Lee.
Yeah, I just want to make a comment. So throughout my career and in my last role, people participation has been hugely important. And I could not really imagine doing my job without. And the further away you get, I get, anyway, I'm talking myself, the further away I get from the point of care, the more anxious I get about not being in touch with the point of care. And I think I'm probably furthest away as I could possibly be in my current role. So I really want us to be more ambitious. And the idea that, we're doing education training, we're arm's length body, we're not really a care delivery organisation, is not a reason at all. In fact, it's all the more, for me, the reason why we have to make sure we get this right. And then the final thing is, it's a struggle. So I'm hugely appreciative of patience that our People Advisory Forum will have with us in helping us on the journey to realise what we don't know and make the most of it.
Well said, Naveena. You can get further away. You know, you can be a chair of an organisation, that's further away. But anyway, Lee Whitehead.
Thanks for that. And thanks for the presentation, Liz and Phil. Really, really good. I mean, I came to the meeting last week to talk about best place to work and really enjoyed the whole meeting. And there was an entirely reasonable challenge about why we hadn't engaged colleagues more in the work around values and behaviours. And that's something that we've pledged we'll come back and do some work with you on, because I think it's a really important area for us to engage with you on. But I just want to probe a bit more on the change from Patients Advisory Forum to People Advisory Forum. One of the big challenges of the communications bit of the NHS is how we talk about people we serve. We talk about patients or service users or customers or consumers or citizens, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But I think fundamentally it all comes down to people. We are people first. And the one conversation we're having around values and behaviours is about how we need to be people-centred as an organisation. And Naveena has talked previously about how, you know, everything we do is about developing people into professionals to support people in the NHS. So I think what the question I'm going to ask is, how do we make sure that the change of focus from patients to people in terms of how you do your work is reflected in how you engage beyond your group with a broader set of people to bring even more insight into the organisation, and whether there's any tools or resources we can put in place to help you have broader conversations. I think the broader they are, the better they are.
Do you want us to pick that up now, Sir David?
Let me get everybody in, Liz, and you can sweep it all up at the end. So, Andrew Foster, please.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask about any interrelationship with the regulatory bodies like the NMC and GMC. And the reason I ask that is that I'm aware that when it comes to nurse education, the NMC requires patient and public involvement in selection of candidates, in course design, and in delivery of training. I'm not so aware whether the GMC requires the same in medical education. So I'm just wondering if the NMC in particular has been involved in the People's Advisory Programme, Forum, I should say, and the work that they do.
Okay, thanks, Andrew. Soraya?
Thank you. There's very supportive and colleagues, Phil and others on this. Just a question around training for members. I've seen patient forum or people forum work really well, but initially people do need a bit of support and encouragement and clarity of what the purpose is and how that moves forward. And I also wondered whether we'll have a presence on the website. I know there's a little bit on the website at the moment, but some real tangible examples of how the forum interfaces and interacts. And linked to that, whether there is any ambition to grow it further into some regional presence.
Thanks, Ray. Callum?
Yeah, I'll just append my question to Lise, if I may, which is really about how you know getting breadth of input and so forth. And I was just wondering whether there's a way of forging links with similar groups in relation to NHS England, the NHS regions, that kind of thing. So, you know, just in the same way we're trying to do in an executive sense, we're trying to build those bridges so that we've got a cohesive view and vision. I think it might be really helpful to do that with both NHS England and I guess into social care and so forth as well. If there's any ways of sort of forming relationships with corresponding people forums, that sounds like a really good thing to do.
Thanks, Callum. Laura?
I'd just like to kind of thank the forum and draw to everyone's attention just how supportive they are about the D&I agenda. I mean, every time that I've been along or indeed talking about widening participation or any of those agendas, it really does feel very much like kind of home territory for all of you. And I know that you've often said about even time permitting, you'd have it as a standing item because you recognise it's absolutely integral to everything that we do. So I think on behalf of everybody who's involved in that agenda, just want to thank you and just look forward to working more in partnership with you as we move forward.
Thanks, Laura. Giles?
Just two quick observations and really for us perhaps to think about how we, whether the forum engages on a kind of pull or push basis, by which I mean, do we as an organisation think hard enough about how we want to engage on particular areas that we're working on? And the flip side of that, and I'm not sure we do always, and I think there are questions around how we're doing the workforce strategy, which are in terms of the people board, which we might come back to. The other reflection is the flip side, which is sometimes there is only an opportunity for one person to play a role. Elizabeth Monero already mentioned was incredibly helpful when we were allocating with the Higher Education Funding Council the 1,000 extra medical school places, but it did mean that it was just her. And I think, again, thinking about how we get the best of the forum into those situations is probably worth a reflection too.
Really interesting, Giles. Thank you. David Farrelly.
Thanks, David. Yeah, just a comment, really. The PAF have been really supportive of regions in the past and have had really strong connections. And some of that was because of historically we had PAF membership on all of the LEPIs. And of course, now that context is changing, we are looking at how do we redefine that role, because regions are really keen to get PAF support on a range of areas and issues running through their SMT. So I'm hoping that we can reshape
what that work will be, but really engage them at a local level, because I think the future work going on at region through ICS, etc., be really important to get people's voices from PAF. So really enjoy doing some more work with you on reshaping the approach.
Okay. Thanks, colleagues. So Liz and Phil, you've got lots to go at there. Naveena said this is really complicated, and then I think you've just had about 8 people ask you to do more. So I think it's absolutely your prerogative to cherry pick what you want to respond to as we go through this. But you can both have the last word. I think what you've got is a ringing endorsement from colleagues about the work that you've been doing and support for the agenda. And the fact that people want you to do more is actually, I think, reflective of just how much you have achieved and what the potential still is. To co-produce with people who have the lived experience to make sure that we never lose that connection with lived experience. So, but Liz and Phil, you can both have the last word. I don't know how you're going to do this, but I'll leave you to work it out. If you're that good, as people say, you'll work it out, I'm sure.
So, Phil, do you want me to kick off with some answers? And then, obviously, I've been at this less than you, so you'll have some things to come back
in. I think you jump in as well, yeah.
So I think that the regional presence is a good point, and partly sort of holding back on full recruitment was to see what happened with Let Bees and what would happen with regions. So we do intend to have some regional presence on PATH. Somebody asked about training for members. So there is training sort of on an ongoing basis. So when we had to move on to Teams to do things virtually, Liz, Kelly, Jocelyn sat down with members and went through all that. So there's training on an ongoing basis for transactional things like that. But we're also this training day that we're going to have. We've talked about this before at board, was with Eden Child, and we should have had it a month ago, but poor Eden was poorly. But what it hasn't been a bad thing, that actually, I mean, bad for Eden, obviously, but we've been able to think about how would we want to share that, because we're going to do some sort of learning and sharing, but we think we want to do more with Eden about shaping the future of PATH, what training we might need, how we go forward. So it's a good opportunity actually for us to do that, and that's coming up in June. So we are thinking about all that. Lee, you asked about the presence of website and comms. We do a lot of work with comms, and we've got a new comms person, Ishmael, who came along with Noella Bella Castro this week to talk about the future going forward. And I think Phil touched in the presentation about more on social media, more on the website, how we really sort of focus the comms to show what PATH are doing and how we can engage. And Giles, I think you asked about, is this a sort of a pull or a push model? Liz, F and Phil might want to go into more detail, but we're approached by HE particular groups, say, can we have a PATH member on? There's a form that's filled in, say, what sort of skills would you want? But maybe we could do a bit more about that to refine it so people know that PATH's here and what it can contribute, and also what the experience and skills of the members are, actually, so we can make sure we cover the appropriate things. I'll leave a regulatory body maybe to Mark. And I think, David, you talked about achievements, which Phil might want to come in on, because I know Phil touched about top hall and carers resource in the presentation. But one of the things that we discussed last week, which just was really fantastic, was PATH's involvement in the new patient safety syllabus, and that will be rolling out across all NHS staff in England. So that was a real great thing that PATH's been involved in that and being able to shape it and contribute to it. So there's all sorts of achievements, but maybe I should leave that to Phil, Mark and Liz, who have been with this for longer than I have. So Phil, do you want to come in there, or do you want to have the last word after Mark and Liz?
Do you want me to wrap it up at the end? I'll do that at the end.
Okay.
Just a quick point then, Sir David, and just to build on what Liz and Phil have said previously. Yeah, the connections, I think Andrew Foster's challenge and question, I think, is a really important one around the interconnectedness of our work. And yes, I think, you know, as an example, the work we've been doing with Skills for Care, as an example, with the Oliver McGowan Mandatory Training Programme in terms of co-production, I think is a really good example where we've used expertise in the development of that. I'll speak with Andrew, the chief executive of the NMC, about what further work we can do, and Phil and I and Liz can have a conversation, because it does sound like some of those strategic connections of work would be really helpful to take forward. But you're right, at a local level, this is very much how we go about recruitment into programmes.
Liz Fenton, are you coming in? Is there anything you want to say? And then I'll give Phil the last word.
I think just very quickly talk about, you asked about what we're most proud of, and I think we would all admit we've got a long way to go towards true co-production, but we are making steps in that direction. And I think a really good example is the role that Theo and Amy have played in the blended learning programme. They've worked with that team right from developing the tender specifications. They were involved in the interviews. They met with the universities that are delivering. And actually, as soon as things allow, they're actually going to go and visit the sites that are going to be delivering the programme. So, and they've provided some really insightful thoughts and comments that has really shaped that work. So I think what I would say that we're most proud of is the way we're evolving and have that ambition to be truly working and co-producing together.
Very helpful, Liz. Some good examples coming out as well, so thank you. Phil, last word to you, my friend.
Yes, I think just touching on some of the induction, I think it's really important. We bolstered the induction this time and PAF members supported that induction. So we almost have a very informal kind of buddy system where we have lots of conversations offline, not just at meetings and not just at virtual meetings, about how we support each other and the various mechanisms. So I think that works really well. What we have done, I think, is we've recruited, certainly this time, vastly experienced people to be involved. And they've, you know, I mean, Theo, for example, set up the first, if you like, the first kind of children's council at the hospital he was receiving services at. So they've led, and then that led on to the kind of youth council for NHS England. So we've got some really kind of transformational people involved in PATH. I think one of the proudest things that I've been involved in and linked to is the nursing associate work that the HE did. And actually there was a huge amount of lived experience just to talk about what that might even look like and how would that mean for patients. So I think really, 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 really proud of that. I think it's really exciting times, and I think it is about how we connect wider than just the member we've got. Lots of us have our own networks and we're involved in lots of other things as well, and think how we bring that together. But then actually, how do we go out and support the region? I think it's so important that we link to the new systems and the ICSs and the things like that, so we can still drive that lived experience forward. But I think, you know, and I don't just say this lightly, I've worked with lots of involvement across the country, either local or nationally. Actually, there's a real sense of the values being owned at HEE. It's never just a tokenistic thing. People never just say, oh, it's about this, it's about that. Actually, people really do want to listen. And you've demonstrated that as a board today. So I'm really heartfelt thanks that you're so passionate, as we are on as members of PATH, really, to drive lived experience forward for HEE. So thank you.
Thank you. I think it's been a terrific session. So, Liz, Phil, thank you for doing that. Phil, thank you for your generosity of your feedback to us and the appreciation. I think there's a really important lesson for us as an organisation that transformation and reform, which improves people's lived experience, is going to be supported. And I, this might play to Giles's point, I wonder whether we need to do more to get the voice of those of you with lived experience much more prominent in the work that we do, and particularly on the reform and transformation agenda. Let's keep this conversation going. I think, Liz Fenton, your point about this is work in progress. Let's not be in any way complacent about what we've done, but actually let's push on and really get the prizes that can result as a consequence of working in this way. It gives me great optimism for the future, and a really massive well done to you, Liz, and to you, Phil, Mark, Liz Fenton, for the way that we've, in a sense, re-energized this forum and actually given it the focus that it's got. I love the bit about the younger people that are involved and bringing in those different perspectives as well. There is a sense that this stuff can be dominated by people that are older, and I think getting that younger voice in is just so, so important. So massive, massive well done. Really great to have this conversation, Liz, before we do your end of year review, I think. So we've almost done it in public, but listen, thanks very much indeed.
Phil, you're more than welcome to join us for the rest of the meeting if you want to do, but a big thank you to you. But with that, I think the agenda says a 10-minute break now. I think we're running about 9 minutes behind, so I am going to catch this up to give us a hard finish at 1 o'clock, Wendy and team, if I just put you on notice for that. But let's have a break for 10 minutes. So if we could be back at 44, please, 11:44, and we'll kick off with the... Wendy, the engagement. It's the best place to work in the Women's Network. So Ajibola and Loretta, I think, are joining us at 44, I think, if we could come back. Thank you. Hi, Rob. Hi, Simon.
Good morning. Hi,
Simon. I nearly put a tie on this morning, and clearly you're setting the bar very, very high and embarrassing all of us that are sat here in more Sunday and Saturday gear than Monday to Friday gear. So thank you for honouring us with your sartorial elegance. It's greatly appreciated.
First meeting of the morning, as soon as the meeting started, Alan Ryan said, "It must be a board day. You've got a suit on."
And I thought that's what you were doing for your patients. I thought you'd been in surgery this morning, but hey, Paul. Right. Thanks all for getting back. thank you, Colin. Naveena, are you going to introduce this and just play us in? Your name is against the best place to work, but if you introduce Ajibola and Loretta, and then let's kick this off. If we could go to 12 o'clock, just 1 or 2 minutes after 12, in terms of just managing time. But Naveena, over to you, please.
Yeah, just by way of introduction, very quickly, this is a really important part of our series of making sure that the board stays in touch with our staff and the issues that matter to our staff and colleagues as part of making HE the best place to work. So today we have our very active and vibrant women's network with lots of ideas for improvement. I've spent a little bit of time with them myself, and so it's great to have them with us to share their thoughts about how we can improve and make HE the best place to work. Over to you.
Thank you for that introduction, Naveena. And thank you for having us in the meeting, Sir David. I'm just going to share my screen, if that's okay. We have a presentation to run through. So my name's Loretta James, and I'm a project support officer within the medical and dental recruitment systems team. I'm also co-chair of the Women's Network and have been since about September, October 2020. So also on the call is Aji Michael. Aji, did you want to just introduce yourself?
Yes, sure. Hi, my name is Aji Michael, Ajibola Michael, and I'm the regional programmes lead for East of England. And I've also been the co-chair just about the same time as Loretta, isn't it? I think that's about time we were three. Yeah, with Eric to Thomas. Yeah.
OK. So as I said, thank you for having us. What I'm going to do is just run through a few slides, and I'll pass over to Aji at some point as well, and she'll run through a few. We really appreciate this opportunity to speak to the board, because it's an opportunity for us to tell you about some of the things that the network's achieved over the past 12 months. And while we're here, we thought we'd take the opportunity to also highlight a couple of ways in which we felt that maybe the board could support the network in achieving our objectives. Firstly, in terms of some formal recognition for the time, hard work and dedication that's been displayed by the staff who volunteer their time to administer the work of the network. And also access to capacity building opportunities such as training for steering group members and or other regular resources. In addition, we would like to ask the board for a formalised executive sponsor to help give the network more leverage when it's needed. And over the next few slides, we'll explain why it is that we think that these things will help the network support HE in achieving that best place to work objective. OK, so if I just tell you a little bit about who we are. So the network was established just over a year ago. The first meeting was held in April 2020, at which point we had 14 members. So those 14 members formed the first Women's Network Steering Group. Six of those founding members are still part of the steering group today. But as you will see as I go through the presentation, the network has grown substantially in that time. So the network represents the collective voice of women within HEE. And our aim is to create a culture that's both diverse and inclusive, but also to create a culture that enables women within the organisation to thrive within HEE, within NHS and within life in general. As mentioned, we do believe that the Women's Network, along with all of the other staff networks, are key to helping HEE become that best place to work. So the Women's Network is open for anyone in HE to join. So we have members and we also have allies from across the business. While we're here, I wanted to take the opportunity to say if anyone on the call or in the meeting is interested in finding out more information about the network or wants to join, or anyone who watches the recording at a later date, please don't hesitate to email us at womensnetwork@hee.nhs.uk. So how do we deliver our work? The structure of the network is made of two co-chairs, Aggie and myself. And then at any one point, we have 12 steering group members, or up to 12 steering group members. And these 12 members lead on and drive forward all network activities. When we send over the papers for this meeting, we had 177 network members. That's actually gone up to 190 as of yesterday. And that includes full members and allies, and these are spread across all HEE regions. So the network and the work that we deliver falls into four different work streams. So we have leadership and career development, and this work stream looks to improve skills and opportunities for women within HEE. We also have the women's health work stream, and within this work stream, we try to raise awareness of women's specific health issues and also try to provide a supportive environment for those people who are affected by those. Our communications and engagement work stream looks at how we interact with members and with the wider organisation. And then our newly established strategy, development and accountability workstream basically plans how we deliver all of the work that I've mentioned, and also make sure that we are doing what we say we're going to do. So as a network, we offer a number of benefits to our members. A couple of these Aggie is going to talk about in more detail in a moment. But if I could just give you a quick overview of the types of things that we offer. We offer a mentoring scheme for women. We have bi-monthly meetings. The theme of those meetings changes for each meeting. Sometimes we have inspirational speakers, sometimes we run workshops. It all depends on what's happening in the network at the time. We have a book club, and we also run ad hoc lunch and learn sessions, and those are really driven by feedback and requests from network members. And finally, we offer a shared virtual team space, and this is used to both communicate as a network to our members, but also for members to have that safe space where they can talk to each other about any issues that happen to be occurring or arising at any time. Okay, so I'm just going to pass you on to Aggie, who is going to talk to you a little bit about our achievements to date.
Yeah, excuse me. Yeah, thank you so much, Loretta, for that. All right, so to date, in less than a year, we've been able to, first of all, we've set up an e-sign-up, like Loretta mentioned. The network membership is increased about 190. And this is also, we attributed to the e-sign-up easier process, where people can generally join our membership to be part of us. And also, like Loretta also mentioned earlier on, we have a shared space, which we feel has been able to give women the opportunity to, you know, have a dedicated space to air their views, share experiences and concerns in a safe place, and also to be able to have that kind of supportive space where you know that, you know, I'm not alone, someone has gone through whatever it is that members are going through. Also, you know, we have four clearly defined work streams. This is taken a lot of time for us to put this together through engagement, survey, so that we know that steering group members can dedicate their time to the works that we feel that will benefit women within AGE, and again, to make AGE best place to work, which are areas that we've been highlighted earlier on around those four key work streams. So that's taken a lot of time. Sometimes we work weekends and even at all times in the evenings. And also, we have now a platform for progression and career fulfillment. And this is one of the key things that we're so excited about. You know, we've shared that with Laura Roberts. We also shared that with Navina. And I'm going to talk you through the work around the career mentoring circle, which we established. We had a pilot last year, October, and we would now plan to run the second part of it, another version, or what we call it, version two, in October, next month, May. And next slide, please. Okay, so in terms of the creating the platform for career progression, so last year, October, we established Career Mentoring Circle. And this was a pilot program. Again, this is driven by feedback from members around some of the issues that they're having around their career. We, some of our members, they're not clear in terms of what it is they want to achieve in life. Why am I in AGE? Why am I in the NHS as they all? So we looked at, and some people are struggling. They're not sure, do I go for a master's degree? What sort of skills should I be looking at if I need to for career progression? And we have some people who have mothers, you know, people who have, I mean, carers responsibility. And also we have people who are just in between. They're not sure, we sort of, should I be, am I supposed to be in the particular department, or why am I even in the NHS as a whole? So we now decided to have these, based on members' feedback, to have these four categories of mentoring circle, which is career vision, career skills, career balance, and career transition. So in total, we have six circles in total. The highest demand is around career vision. But because of because this is a pilot, we have to reduce this to maximum of 36 women. Whilst the program started, three dropped out within the 2 weeks of the launch. This is largely due to the workload capacity issues. And 16 program modules were created, and all these programs were completed by the members, by the participant. We had six facilitators, volunteer facilitators from our colleagues within AGE as well. And we have representatives across all AGE footprint. Next slide, please, Loretta. Thank you. Yeah. So, I mean, apart from some of the results were really, we may not be able to capture them here. You know, like, you know, we keep having like a daily basis, we keep telling people congratulations around some of the success stories we have. So far, we've had members who have said they've got 65 promotions. We have people, in fact, recently, I think last week, Loretta, someone also reported to have been offered a new role just because she's attended a career mentoring circle. We have people who've taken secondment, that's five people. People also, you know, taking more projects because they've been able to have, they're more confident in themselves. And a lot of people have reported to have a mindset shift. Next slide, Loretta. We're able to provide that in more detail if you require in terms of a further breakdown. We have members who've given feedback. Thanks again, like one said, thanks again for everything you've done. It's an exceptional first impression of AGE, which I think is a good impression of someone just joining AGE. And we also have, I mean, we've had members around who joined the Career Balance who has been able to identify that boundaries are the issues they have, and they've been able to take control of their time and say no. They've learned how to say no to certain things. We've had members who've reported to begin to have good relationship with their managers because now they've taken control of their appraisal and their one-to-one. They know how to approach one-to-one because we feel that this is a two-way relationship. There's so much responsibility or so much expectations from managers. Women have not been able to be more confident about how they approach their own career within AGE. And we have someone who's also, you know, commented that they're leaving AGE, you know, because they've attended this program and they feel that this is around career transition. They've been able to determine or decide, you know, the sort of role they want. And, you know, it might seem like a loss to AGE, but I think this is a good thing that people, because we want people who are more aligned to our values, not necessarily because they want to be here because they need a job. Yes, next slide, Loretta. Okay, so I'm going to hand over to Loretta to talk about the Women's History Month. Thank you.
Thank you, Ajay.
Okay. So this is the reason that we were initially invited to this meeting, and it was to talk about some of the activities that took place during Women's History Month and reflect on some of the outcomes from that. So for those who don't know, Women's History Month took place in March, from the 1st to the 31st of March, and within that, International Women's Day took place on the 8th of March. So the Women's Network worked with communications and diversity, inclusion and participation in order to deliver a programme of activities throughout the month. So the aims of the programme were to start conversations about gender bias and inequality, to encourage staff to choose to challenge gender bias in the workplace, and also to raise awareness and increase membership of the Women's Network. So the highlight of the programme was the all-staff webinar takeover on the 10th of March, and that involved a panel made up from Women's Network members and Naveena, and Women's Network members were invited prior to the event to submit questions based on the themes of the event, which were pay inequalities or gender pay gap, women's health and supporting women into leadership. So on the day, these questions were posed to the panel members and they gave their own personal take on responses to those. So during the event, we had 992 attendees. And of those attendees who completed the post-event survey, 94% found the webinar useful. We also invited attendees to ask questions in Slido. During the event, we received 46 questions, and they covered a number of themes, but the top themes were around exit interviews, transitions between teams, and women's health. So during Women's History Month, we also ran regular personal experience stories, and these were from members, non-members, and allies alike. And they covered a number of themes, including inspirational women, whether they be inspirational women in people's lives or inspirational women from history, and also topics such as personal achievement and personal health experiences. Alongside this, we had conversations on Yammer. The theme for International Women's Day this year was Choose to Challenge, and staff were invited to make pledges based on this theme. Those pledges would be made with staff either sending in photos with a pledge card stating what their pledge was, or in the International Women's Day pose. During the month, 29 members of staff made pledges, and that included 5 ally pledges, which was really good to see. Also, during the month, we worked with Melanie Holloway from Diversity, Inclusion and Participation, and she shared a gender bias survey which aimed to demonstrate the extent to which women experience gender bias in the workplace. And although outcomes from that survey haven't been shared widely yet, we are working with and actually meeting with the DIMP team next week to plan how best to use that data to maximum effect. So in terms of those aims that I mentioned earlier, the Choose to Challenge pledges that we were looking for were made. The conversations were definitely started, and the network welcomed 39 new members over the month, 19 of those members signing up within 48 hours of that all-staff webinar. Okay, and then I'm just going to pass back to Adji for the last part of the presentation, which is all around next steps for the Women's Network.
All right, thank you, Loretta. So before I go now, I just want to say a big thank you. You know, like Loretta mentioned that the engagement around the webinar, and I just want to give this credit to Naveena because you really did. I mean, we invited Naveena at one of our meetings where we showcased the, shall I say, graduates, participant of the career mentoring circle, and we applauded the ladies. So, and Naveena did spoke about the career mentoring, you know, some of the good work we've done. So I feel that really impacted the rate of, I mean, the membership that we're having now, right now. So, and also want to say thank you to Laura Roberts. You know, she's been so supportive. The D&I team, really great. You know, she's each time, you know, when we started this career mentoring circle, actually approached Laura to say, this is what we're thinking. This is what the women needed, you know, around, you know, mentoring, etc. So I want to say thank you also to Wendy Reed. We've always been picking our brains around what should we do, what should we be looking at, you know, so it's really been great. It's just good to mention that right now. So the first next step for us is around structures and enablers. Now, we've had a lot of women come through, oh, I want to do fantastic, I want to support this work, but really this, because it's a new network, unlike some other networks, and because it's national, unlike some other networks that have been established for years. So I consider this more like a startup. So many things, we're beginning to create the forms ourselves. Everything is just being done afresh. And it takes a lot of time, you know. So some of this time, some of this work, this piece of work has been done, you know, evenings by our own personal time. Now, so thanks to the money it's been given us by D&I team, so we've hired a consultant to help us to put some strategic planning in place, which is a 3-year strategic plan to develop some processes and onboarding new members, onboarding steering group members, so that, you know, this work can just, you know, run on its own, just like automated, so to say, and also to help us create some processes around our career mentoring circle. So that's what we've used that money to do, just to ease off some of this work on the chairs as well of the steering group members. So that's it's good to know that. And also, like pointed out earlier on in the presentation, that we want, we're asking the board for formal recognition of the steering group members' activities in appraisals. Now, we have a lot of women that have come up to want to participate, but most of the time, the work has been slow because of the time, you know, required to do the work for the women to drive the vision forward. This afternoon, we're meeting with the women. We want to look at our objectives to see if they're, you know, and the activities that we need to be doing. Again, this is going to take some time. And sometimes, you know, members do come to for meetings to do this sort of bit of work. But in terms of driving this vision, it requires them. So if we can get formal recognition, you know, around this piece of work, that would really be good. And largely, we require a sponsor, executive sponsor. Some of the rumors when we started this women's network generally is people feel that it's a tick box exercise by HEE. But I think by Navina endorsing, you know, and also Laura Roberts' support, has made people feel that, no, this is not a tick box exercise, that really, that, you know, that the board is actually in support of what we are doing. So by having an executive board level sponsor to be, you know, so we can kind of like have a feed forward, you know, that will really showcase that this is not just a tick box exercise, that, you know, the HEE means business. And next step for us again is the career mentoring circle. Like we said, now it's going to be a rolling program twice yearly. It's an informal where, you know, women supporting women and, you know, to support themselves. We develop the programs, we develop facilitators guide. We're meeting on the 30th of April to train new facilitators. And so every graduate will train themselves. And that's how we intend to continue to roll it twice a year. We'll continue to work in, to align like priority areas, like it's been established. I think it's in Appendix 1 around our objectives that we've created, that Loretta mentioned earlier on, and also to work with the D&I around the gender bias survey that was created. And we've started a new series. We're in the middle of starting a new series, which we call the New Normal for Working Moms. You know, so it's a focus group to support, you know, so we had a lot of members, you know, they've been on maternity leave, and by the time they come back, they got back into a lockdown. So this is the kind of conversations we're going to be having right now around the new normal. What does it look like for working moms? So that's the next series. And not just working moms. People have come back to say, why are you saying working moms? We're working parents. So we've reached out to the Carers Network to see how we can collaborate. So it can be rather new normal for working moms or new normal for working parents. We don't know yet. But we're meeting this afternoon, and we will be discussing with the Wired Network, you know, how we move that forward. So we intend that at the end of this, by the time we have these focus sessions again, some piece of work and, I mean, advice can come, you know, we can share with HR colleagues to say this is what we feel that new normal should look for women within HEE. That's me done. Thank you. If you have any questions. So I think we just have an appendix around what our objectives. If you just want to scroll, Loretta, for each network. If, you know.
Sorry, I think we're actually over time now, but the papers were sent out prior to the meeting. So if anyone does want to have a look at any further detail, just scroll to the end of the presentation and there are a few appendices down there. Okay. So thank you for listening to us.
Thank you, Loretta. Andrew Michael, thank you to you too. Really clear presentations, and I don't know why you need a consultant for the structure. I mean, this is the most structured presentation from a network that I have ever seen, quite frankly, and I mean that as a positive. So thank you for that. I'm really not going to open this up. Time is not on our side, so I hope you don't take that as affirmation of the fear that this is all about tick boxes. It definitely isn't about tick boxes. Laura, on our behalf as a board, can I ask you just to pick up the asks that Loretta and Haji Michael have made twice now, once at the beginning of the presentation and once at the end? It's almost a textbook example of public speaking. Tell them what you're going to tell them, and then tell them what you've told them. So I think we've got the message around exec sponsors and a recognition of the time and the investment that you've got. So I do think we've thought about this, but perhaps we might need just to have further conversation, Laura, if I could ask you to do that. And if we need to think more broadly about our policy around the networks and how we make this work, then we'll have to do that. Just on your working mums bit, I'm just struck by how many people that have been working from home and doing homeschooling. Every person I know where that has happened, it's fallen on the woman in the family to actually do the homeschooling, particularly during the day. So I suspect there are aspects to continue to work at as we go into a much more blended approach to how we work in the future. So perhaps there are things here for this network to pick up with the piece of work about the future of work that we've got in hand. But with that, I'm sorry, Loretta and Haji Michael, time is not on our side, but that was a fabulous presentation. I don't know whether you can see the chat boxes, but what people are saying is just how good the presentation was. So thank you both for your presentation, and good luck with your meeting this afternoon. For board colleagues, Women's Network, all one word, at hee.nhs.uk gives you the opportunity to pass any comments directly to Loretta James and Haji Michael if you would want to do that. Naveena.
Thank you, Sir David.
Thank you. Just to say, Sir David, for the benefit of our Women's Network leaders, that the work that we will do to develop the ideas will be, we will take it to be monitored through the people committee. So this is, you know, a lot of the feedback from here, and I'm sure Andrew Foster, as the chair of people committee, will be expecting us to bring our plans. Yeah, so that's where we will be following up on actions.
Okay, brilliant. So you're more than welcome, Loretta and Haji Michael, to stay for the rest of the agenda. Or if you need to go and prepare for your meeting, then we'll leave you to make your decision. You clearly demonstrated you're more than capable of doing that. So I don't think. Yeah. Big thank you. So let's move on now to focus on trainees. So Wendy, there are three components to this item. Can I leave you just to adjust how you present and just mastermind this, so we can get we can do justice to all three items? But I'll leave that with you. You know how you can make the presentation in the time available. Loretta, I don't know whether you could clear the screen. I think you're sharing your screen, and then we can get the meeting back up. Brilliant. Thank you. No need to apologise. So, Wendy, I'll let you mastermind these next three sections.
Okay, thank you. I've got my colleague, Professor Radford, to keep me straight. We're going to hand over to Sam Illingworth to run through what is actually a very wide-ranging programme, just to give the board a sense of the breadth of learner engagement, how we not only work across our systems but others, and the diversity of what we are hearing from our learners. I think the important questions that we ask, you know, we've heard, we did, you asked, we listened, those are the things that underpin much of this work. A key element of how we work out our continuing commitment to both quality improvement and get assurance of the quality of training through the pandemic was to not forget about our processes, which is really quite remarkable given that everything else was suspended. You know, the National Quality Board was suspended, the Joint Strategic Oversight Group was suspended. So I want to pay tribute to our teams in the regions and locally who absolutely wanted to make sure that our students and trainees had properly supported experiences, even when they were working in the front line of the pandemic. And you'll see some of that come through. This is a multi-professional approach to what we hear from our learners, and you'll see some of the various focus come through. Giles has led on the most recent Pulse survey, and we've wrapped that into the slides just for the board to see where we're going, but he will obviously be able to answer detailed questions on that. And we have the two people that have had the first national trainee forum, which will be happening for its second time in June with Chris Whitty attending. So we've got a number of people on the call that can both learn from the comments and perhaps add in at the end of it. So I'm going to hand over to Sam to briefly go through the slides, which are a reference for the board and obviously for members to come back in due course.
Thanks, Wendy. I'm very conscious of time, so I won't go through the slides in any level of detail. I hope the board have found them helpful to look through. But I guess, as Wendy was saying, there is something here about us just recognising that student and trainee voice is absolutely at the heart of how we quality assure education and training. It is the first port of call when we think there are concerns or there might be quality issues in training and education. It's the first thing that we do is check that with our students and trainees. And likewise, it's also the place that we find and mine good practice. So where we recognise really good training and great experience from trainees and students is where we tend to find that through our engagement with trainees and our feedback. What we've attempted to do in the slide is kind of set that some of that context for you. We are currently refreshing our quality framework, and for me this has been a great opportunity for us to build on how we use learner voice and really think about how we systematise some of that feedback loop. We've got huge numbers of vehicles by which we seek and obtain student and trainee feedback. What we're probably less good at doing is closing that feedback loop. So really visibly saying to students and trainees, thank you for engaging with us. This is what we found from it, and this is the outcome of your engagement. This is what we're doing to respond and act upon that learner voice. And we're really keen through the refresh of the quality framework that we really build in a way to systematise that. There's lots of we've undertaken a huge amount of engagement to refresh the framework. We've done a lot of online given current circumstances, and we've had the engagement of over 300 people in that process. And what we're finding is that our partners and stakeholders really want us to emphasise in the refresh well-being, not only of students and trainees, but actually of educators as well. They want us to emphasise equality, diversity and inclusion in how we look at quality through the framework. They want us to learn from and embed the innovation digital agenda that we've seen, an explosion and real progress over the last 12 months. They want us to really reflect on the partnerships with ICSs and how they can, those new structures, those new partnerships and leadership at local level can really help us improve quality of training. And again, they want us to really think about and look at how we strengthen learner and student voice, as I said, that sort of feedback loop. So we're thinking about how we can really do that and make that visible. So the slides have some illustrative case studies of how we seek feedback, how we seek engagement, and Wendy's mentioned some of those. I'd put them in sort of five broad themes. There are sort of those cyclical annual or biannual surveys that we undertake, like the National Education and Training Survey that I'll highlight a bit later, the GMC-NTS survey, etc. We also do more rapid and if you like, action in surveys and
focus groups as well, where we think there's an issue, whether it's be quality or other. We often now do very rapid surveys or focus groups, webinars, etc. And during COVID, in the last summer, the impact on of COVID on student survey we ran for the final year nursing students and medical students that graduated and were deployed to support training. It was a great way of us having a very rapid review of how their experience was, whether their induction was good. There's a raft of forums that we've got, national and regional and very local level. Our regional teams use virtual forums very regularly now. And as Wendy said, the last 12 months has really necessitated that. And actually, it's taught us that we can far more readily and accessibly seek feedback to, with students and engagement along those lines. There are obviously ongoing touch points throughout a training pathway. So there's an illustration in the pack, particularly for medical trainees, for that you know there are touch points along undergraduate and into postgraduate where our engagement with and our trainers and his engagement with trainees can give us a really good view of experience and quality at the time. And as Wendy mentioned more recently, a sort of direct engagement that through the whether it be a pulse survey that Giles and team recently undertook that was more about the trainees' experience of HE, you know, what's it like to be on the receiving end of HE, as it were, and more of our forums are looking to those things as well. So, Nick, if you could just go on to slide 6, I just want to highlight that, as I said, we really want to embed this systematic feedback loop. And I think Giles's pulse survey kind of highlighted, I think it's on the next one, Nick. Giles's pulse survey kind of highlighted this as well, that really welcomed, I think, that trainees being engaged by HEE, but I think there's lots more that we can do in terms of really closing that feedback loop. We now have 7 in each of the regions, what we've designated as quality analysts who work very closely with us to connect the regional and national work around how we seek feedback and how we undertake engagement. But more importantly, we're really keen to run some national and regional campaigns in terms of you said we did. So really focusing on our quality initiatives and quality improvements. And there's a number of case studies that we want to highlight that's really been driven by student and trainee voice. So a bit further down, I'll cover from slide 9, Nick, if that's all right. We've got some case studies that we wanted to share with you that really highlight where we have been seeking feedback and how we've done it. There's Wendy mentioned the National Trainee Engagement Forum, which was launched on the 10th of March by Reyes and Verducci. I think they're on the call with the board today. And the first of many, I hope, engagement from trainees who we want to seek input and collaboration with around our general reforms. We had a really great first meeting with them, first launch, where Celia Ingham-Clark presented and shared some of the experience from an E&I perspective around COVID and some of the learning there. And Wendy shared, as a high level, some of the reforms that we're seeking to progress. And some really, really good engagement from the trainees on the call. We're looking to run this monthly, and as Wendy said, Chris Whitty has committed to come to our next one. But we really want to. We've got regional representation from across HEE of trainees, and they have a network of trainees that they'll engage with on our behalf. So lots to build on there. The next one that we're going to highlight is the
And I think Liz Fenton is on the call and can maybe highlight some of this around the student nurse, midwife and nursing associate shared decision-making council. Liz, do you want to...
Yeah, thank you, Sam. Thank you very much. And I will be brief because I know we're tight for time. I think over the last 12 months, we've all recognised that listening and engaging with our learners has never really been any more important than it is now. And we established the Student Nurse, Midwife and Nursing Associate Shared Decision-Making Council last year. And it's just one way we put students at the centre of our work and how we help them, enable them to share in our decision-making. We meet monthly and we use this collective leadership approach, working with the group in areas that to date have included shaping how we can develop student nurse placements within HEE and also considering why students may not complete their learning programmes linked to the repair work. The group works alongside a number of shared decision-making councils that are championed by Mark and by our Chief Nursing Officer for England. We're currently growing our membership to ensure that we're really representative across the professions, our regions and the branches of nursing. And our agendas are really led by the members and they select a chair to lead each of the meetings. But we also think it's really important that they get something back from this. So we've really tried to embed some learning and development principles in there for them. So our May meeting will be a session on the professional use of social media, which will support the work they're going to do with us around the International Day of the Nurse that's in May. So that's a quick whistle stop around the Shared Decision Making Council. Thank you.
Thanks, Sam, can I ask you to do this in the next 2 to 3 minutes?
Sure.
Please.
Yeah, no problem, Sir David. So, Nick, if you just slide down to the back end of the slide set, what I'd like to sort of illustrate is how we use some of that feedback and engagement in some of our quality improvement initiatives. So, slide... There we go. So we some of you will be familiar with the Wellbeing Commission that was launched in 2018. And since its publication, there's been a range of recommendations and initiatives that have been embedded. And I have to say all of the commission was very much driven by student and trainees, both in terms of developing the commission itself, but in terms of the initiatives that are in there. So we have now wellbeing guardians in every trust that have a connection to the board, wellness inductions that have been rolled out across staff and learners across England. The next slide covers the support initiative, again very much driven by the voice of trainees, particularly during the junior doctor contract disputes, and we launched this initiative in 2018 and have done a number of evaluations since then. There's around about 5,000 trainees that step out of training every year for issues such as caring responsibilities or health issues, and they very much felt that they were at a disadvantage when they rejoined training. So we started the supported return to training programme in 2018. And the latest evaluation that we published last month, I think, really highlights the improvements that programme has really kind of embedded for trainees. We supported around about 2,000 trainees from January to December last year to return to training, and that's made up of a number of access to simulation training, coaching and mentoring, and it's meant that those 2,000 trainees have returned to training with more confidence, reduced anxiety and certainly improved patient and learner and trainee safety. A number of other initiatives, Liz mentioned repair as well, and the ICON survey that we ran that I mentioned last year has really helped underpin some of that reducing attrition work that John Clark and colleagues lead. So I hope that gives a sort of a flavour of how we use the student and trainee engagement, how we use the surveys. Next now is at a level where we sent it out in December last year to 150,000 students. We had responses from nearly 40,000, and last month we published a range of professional level and geography based reports, and that really now has given us an ability to look at trends and really systematise that. So that's our sort of, we want to build on the opportunities in the next steps, ensure that we've got greater visibility of what we're hearing and the types of engagement that we're doing, but more importantly, as I said, closing that feedback loop and really illustrating to students and trainees how we're using their voice to improve their training. I'll stop there, Sir David, and I don't know if there are any questions or comments.
Thank you very much, Sam. Let me open it up. I'm going to do this for 7 minutes to 35. Get your hands up, get in, because I'm going to cut it off at 35, wherever we are. It's really important we do justice to outside people that are going to join us at 11:35. So, right, anybody want to come in on this? Andrew, George, and then Soraya, please.
Thank you. Thank you. And this sounds like a really good way of finding out about it. To what extent are we, you know, obviously these surveys are really important for finding out what's important to our trainees and the and so on, or whatever sort. How well are we using them, or how are we thinking about using them as well to sort of orientate themselves to the next stage in their career as they become an independent practitioner? Thinking about the nature of the questions tells them as well what we think is important for them, as well as what's important to them. And so we can start thinking about how we move them forward and prepare them for the next stage. Thank you.
Really interesting question, Andrew. Soraya, please.
Thank you. I've just put it in the chat, actually. I think at People Group, Andrew, with your permission, it would be really good to be able to drill down some of the data, both the quantitative and qualitative data, that actually match it across different characteristics and demographics, just to see if there are any differences emerging that we need to be aware of.
Okay. Anybody else want to come in on this? One of our themes in today's board is where we get feedback from people who are using services, trainees who are going through training, the Women's Network, our staff. So we've had three routes of feedback to us as an organisation. Anybody else? OK, Sam, Wendy, do you want to come back? Oh, Harpreet, I do apologise. Harpreet, please.
Thank you, Sir David. Just a very quick question. On the surveys that we do, Sam, it just seems like on the thing, many of them are national. Are we capturing the kind of the regional and local responses to them and what's happening in local and regions rather than just the national, or is that all factored in? Thank you.
Yeah, I think that builds on Soraya's question, I think, doesn't it, Harpreet? So, Sam, Wendy, do you want... I'll leave it to you.
I'll come back very quickly. Yes, Harpreet, Soraya, we can cut the data in any way at all, and you can actually look down to your local organisation and one rota level. There are some data protection issues with the GMC survey, but not with our data. So if you are going visiting, you can look at the quality reports from that individual organisation. And I think that's very, you're right, it's very, very important because variations that are picked up are going to be picked up locally and regionally long before they're picked up nationally. And that's important information for us if we're to intervene with quality improvement rather than simply in a regulatory space. Andrew, your question about outcomes, we're about to do a piece of work in postgraduate medicine looking at what the offer to those doctors in that final transition year to their CCT. I don't use the phrase independent practice. I don't approve of it. I don't think we work independently as doctors. And that is one of the challenges, actually, this sense of autonomy. For many years, the Royal College of Physicians have done something called a penultimate year assessment, which is very much an assessment. And what we think we have learned from trainees is that they need in their final year that confidence an understanding of what the job of a consultant is going to be, a sense of how they work in a very different team. We know that many of the quality issues in service are around relationships between senior doctors, and we need to step into that space. And we think that by building on what we've learned from the Royal College of Physicians and some of the other programmes, we're going to look at what we offer in the penultimate year. Huge amounts of that will be underpinned by the interviews that we're doing with final year trainees in their COVID recovery space. So we will build the evidence base and then come out with a series of proposals. It is not going to be resource negative. It's going to cost us something, but I think it's a the way in which we weight our input to trainees needs to be slightly different than the one size fits all at the moment. So it's a really good question. Thank you.
And so, David, if I could add, we're obviously sharing this data with partners and stakeholders as well. And it's heartening to see NHS England and Improvement are really interested in the data, because clearly, quality of education and training is very much linked to quality of service, and it adds another layer to, you know, some of the NHS is the best place to work programme work and some of the initiatives there. So we're really starting to join up, you know, the conversation at national and regional level on those on that basis. I think likewise it's informing our conversations with partners like Council of Deans for Health and looking at specific, you know, professional lines or geographies and thinking about how we work more closely with the HEI sector to really drive improvements where we've seen disparities, whether it be geographic or professional based. So lots of interest here, and the tools that we've got now published, I think, are really helpful for not just for trainees and for us to look at quality, but, you know, our sort of wider system partners and HEIs are very interested in this and want to support us building on that.
OK. Just before I close this down, Dushi, please.
Just a comment, Sir David, and I just wanted to say thank you, really, as a trainee, to everybody here who has been listening and engaging with this agenda. The National Trainee Engagement Forum was a great success, and just one of many ways that we've seen trainee engagement now as fellows involved in the organisation. So yeah, just thank you to everybody who's been working on this and continues to work on this as it becomes ever increasingly more important. Thanks.
Thanks, Vidushi, and to Rhys as well for actually the work you've done to get that forum up and running. Sam, Wendy, I wonder whether, you know, to Soraya's question, which I think is a great question about variation, and if we looked at some of this data through an EDI lens as well, what would that tell us? And I think what it will be interesting to do is bring it back to the board, and I'll leave you to work with Naveena to work out how we can do this. As much as anything, this is the feedback loop about the quality of what we offer. And so it's less about what we do as an employer and more about the quality of what we offer. And I think that raises some questions which is worth just thinking about, and whether we've got the appropriate governance for that kind of activity and the quality feedback, particularly around quality improvement. Because the purpose of this is not to find out what people think. The purpose of it is to find out what they think and then drive improvements as a consequence of that feedback. And that's the conversion we're looking for, I think. But big thanks, Sam and Wendy, for drawing this together in the way that you have done today and just giving it the focus. I think, Naveena, if I can ask that we actually just take it away and just give some thought to what the appropriate forum is at a governance level to engage the board. I think it is something that the board needs to take an interest in, and that's not me walking into the exec space. It is just about saying we must, as a board, be concerned about the quality of what the offer is and what our quality improvement processes are once we've got the feedback. If we can leave that there, Sam, a big thank you. And you called out some names of others that have been contributing to this in your presentation. I just want to echo thanks to people for actually getting this going. We can only learn whether we're being successful if we ask people, as well as review the data. And I think combining both of these, as you have been doing over this past 12-month period, is a terrific addition to what HEE has available to it as tools to find out. So a big thank you. So Wendy, I think you've got some colleagues also joining. I think I've seen Kelly Hallhouse join, but let me let you introduce this item for the next 15 minutes, please.
Thank you, Sir David. So this is a follow-up from a presentation that we did, I think, not long before lockdown, a year ago. And I'm really delighted to welcome Maz and Kelly to the board. Maz, I don't think there's anybody in the HE that doesn't know Maz, actually, but just in case you don't, Maz was one of our Faculty of Medical Leadership Clinical Fellows and has stayed with us to develop what is a unique fellowship programme. This is a real feather in our cap because this is the first multi-professional fellowship programme focused on population health. I'm delighted that Kelly's come to share some of her work because it's hugely important to what's happening in the service at the moment. But with grateful support from the board, thank you, we have launched this fellowship a couple of years ago now, and we are now looking at a significant expansion, learning from what's been gone on before. We are looking at Population Health Fellowship as part of a significant workforce reform for all, including doctors. So I'm going to hand over to Maz to briefly introduce Kelly and the programme. And then I think perhaps in the interest of time, we have an open invitation to NEDS to hear more about the programme. If you remember last time we said we were going to set up a World Cafe style, come and interview and meet the fellows who are doing various bits of this. We will do that when we're able to get into a space again. But as I say, I think the representation from Maz and Kelly will give you a flavour of where this exciting programme is. Maz, over to you.
Hi, thanks, Wendy. Thanks. Thanks for having us again. Just to give you a brief overview of the fellowship, we have a cohort of multi-professional staff all across England working on population health projects alongside a formalised talk programme. It was incredibly, incredibly popular. That's not to brag, that's just to say that it's an important space, population health. Lots of staff are interested to learn about this. And I've got Kelly here with us today, a senior physiotherapist who's doing some fantastic work on a long COVID clinic. Kelly, please.
Hi everyone, and thanks for having me this lunchtime to talk a little bit about my experience as with regards to the Population Health Fellowship programme that I've been part of. So first of all, just a little bit of background about me. I'm a physiotherapist, as Maz said. I've been a physio for about 20 years, and for 18 of those years, I've specialised in MSK. I spent the duration of my career working in the northwest of England, with the bulk of it being based in Blackburn, which is a very diverse town that sits within the 20% most deprived areas in the UK. So as such, my day job and clinical role in MSK land presents many challenges of multimorbidity, as well as many cultural and social complexities as well. And this experience is what originally ignited my passion and interest, really, for population health. The idea of exploring this line further, this line of thinking further, should I say, as well as the light bulb moment that AHPs from all different specialities are a potentially untapped resource that could be better placed and more effective at having a positive impact on population health and health inequalities was at the forefront of my mind as my career progressed. When the opportunity came up to apply for the fellowship programme towards the end of 2019, this felt like it was an opportunity that aligned with my interests and passion and provided an opportunity to learn more about the underpinning concepts of population health, develop new skills in this area, and then to go on to practically apply some of these skills via the vehicle of a population health project. And this blended learning format advertised of the programme really sang out to me. Thankfully, I was successful in my application to the programme. And when we first met as a group in February last year, it felt really positive to be joining a network of like-minded people on the same programme. As you may be aware, as part of the programme, all the fellows are assigned to a host organisation to work with, and I was placed with Blackburn and Darwen Local Authority, who incidentally I've done some work with in my day job, but not to the extent that this programme, fellowship programme allows, really. The primary project I was assigned to was to assist the implementation of an active lifestyle hub across Pennine, Lancashire, which is essentially a single point of access to all wellbeing and physical activity services for people living in Pennine Lancashire with an experience one or more long-term condition. From the outset of the fellowship and the very first meeting we had in London in February 2020 with Wendy and Maz and the programme team, we've been encouraged to make the most of every opportunity that the fellowship presented and make as many connections as possible in the field of population health. With that in mind, I'd hit the ground running when the Population Health Fellowship programme started and tried to make some really good contacts within the Northwest region, which stood me in good stead as the world changed in March 2020 and the pandemic hit and the COVID situation developed and all our best laid plans came to a halt. The fellowship was unfortunately paused as we all returned to our clinical duties, rightly so, but thankfully due to some of those connections I'd made pre-lockdown, it enabled me to keep one foot in the door of the world of population health regionally. And this came to fruition as the pandemic evolved and it started to become obvious that alongside the threat of COVID, there was an equally problematic population health issue emerging as health inequalities became highlighted and the phenomenon of post-COVID syndrome started to become obvious. So I was connected with a project looking at the impact of post-COVID syndrome alongside my original project and invited to collaborate with a local consultant in public health and a specialist public health registrar in pulling together a paper scoping out this potential impact of post-COVID, which gave me a working insight of collaborative and clinically driven research, which I believe is an opportunity that may well have eluded me had it not been for my involvement in this fellowship programme. So over several months, our brief was to look at the impact of post-COVID syndrome on our local population, but also to scope out the potential impact on clinical services moving into the current phase of the pandemic and going forwards. We had to move at pace to complete this in order for it to be relevant and for it to be useful to inform service planning, etc. After quite extensive literature reviews and predictive modelling that we did, we completed and presented our paper at several different platforms in our immediate localities, including NHS leaders, public health collaborative board meetings, as well as also presenting at ICS levels and regional Public Health England teams as well, where it was received really positively. The paper itself that we produced and the models used within it mean that it's potentially relevant and transferable to other regions across the UK where services are attempting to predict and anticipate and plan their demand and capacity for those struggling with post-COVID syndrome, and hopefully a multitude of people will find it useful and relevant to their practice. Certainly at a local level up in Blackburn and in Darwen and East Lancashire, our Director of Public Health embraced the paper and very much used it as a building block of the services post-COVID services within the B with D Blackburn with Darwen locality to base planning on. And due to my insight in this topic area, I was invited to be part of that local planning group as well to devise a local service plan to meet the anticipated need of post-COVID patients within East Lancashire, which again has been really good exposure, really good insight into a side of service planning that I wouldn't normally be involved in terms of my day-to-day job. But again, another valuable experience for me, which has really shaped some of my thinking and will shape my approach to work going forward as a result of the fellowship. As things tend to, I've sort of come full circle in terms of my fellowship journey, and that as restrictions started to ease and the fellowship resumed in September last year, I reconnected with my Active Lifestyle Hub project, which was the project right at the beginning. And it really quickly became apparent that actually this would be the cornerstone for our building around post-COVID services. So it's very much coincidental, but it's all interlinked really nicely for me as a complete packaging experience. It obviously continues to be a work in progress, and it will exist beyond my fellowship life, if you will, as well, as we start to think about sustainability of those services. In preparation for today, I've been reflecting a little bit more about my experience of the fellowship so far. I've been really well supported by everybody, by the programme team, by my host organisation, who have involved me in many things beyond the actual project that I was originally assigned to, which has really enhanced my feeling of belonging, my understanding of the team that I've been working with. They've been really, really supportive of me exploring other opportunities outside of their organisation, and it's been very much focused on maximising my progression as a population health practitioner. And you know, that's really why the post-COVID syndrome paper came,
the opportunity was open to me because of their support. They've also been really supportive of me getting engaging with Public Health England colleagues as well, and taking up some other options and opportunities of mentorship and further expansion of my knowledge and skills in that respect. So all of the experience I've had so far have really expanded my skills and knowledge of population health. They will enable me to take this forward and influence any future roles in life post-fellowship, and continue to fight to raise the profile of population health, which is one of the main aims of the fellowship programme, I believe. So thank you for your time. I hope that that's useful and gives you a bit of insight into the population health programme. So thank you for having me.
Brilliant, thank you. Really inspiring, actually. I want to make a comment on this before we finish this item, but I'm going to presume nobody has any other business, and we'll run this item till 5 to 1 o'clock. And 5 to 1 o'clock, Shauna, you can make your second debut and get us through the revalidation report in 5 minutes. It's a formality, I think, and we just need to accept the report. So let's run this for another 7 or so minutes. And the comment I wanted to make, I visited Bristol, North Somerset, South Gloucestershire a couple of weeks ago. Andrew joined part of that visit, but one of the presentations we had was from a GP that was doing some population health work. And what struck me about that work is just how far this will be a feature of work over what I would anticipate is the next decade. And I think the point that you ended on, Kelly, about the extension of your knowledge and skills and how we look to the future. The other interesting connection for me was a visit to Exeter University with Liz Hughes to look at the medical school. And one of the offers there is a master's in data analysis, which is a key component of some of the population health work. So I think what we're beginning to see here is some of the answers to the questions about what will the future look like and how do we begin to prepare for the future. And I think your articulation of your learning, Kelly, was an example of that. But also this point about how do we, I think we're expanding to 26 fellows, is it? So given the size of the NHS, what is our model of change for extending the knowledge that comes from those 26 population health fellows? I think is a really important question that we don't have to answer today, but we do need to begin to take a perspective on. So really great presentation. Maz, Kelly, thanks very much. I know Sanjeev is working on this project and he's with us as well. But let me just open it up. If I'll just take this as comments rather than questions that anybody needs to answer. So anybody, I think, let me just get out of the comment box and into who's got the hand up. Harpreet.
Yes, really, really exciting program, and you know, been following this from the onset. Just two quick points. You know, what is our plan for the continuity for these fellows? So once they leave the fellowship program, how do we keep them within this ecosystem, or at least support them if they need to be supported? And then secondly, you know, I think for a lot of these, many would want to continue this work moving forward and look for roles and opportunities that will allow them to do that. Again, do we have a sense of, is this our kind of responsibility or the wider ecosystems to, you know, find roles and opportunities that will allow the fellows to actually then do this in a full-time capacity, or at least a substantive capacity as part of their jobs?
Great questions, Harpreet. Liz Mayer, please.
Yeah. Thanks, Miles and Kelly. That was a brilliant presentation. And I enjoyed, Kelly, beforehand reading the case study about your experience. And I think what you pulled out in how you described it to us was how supportive your organisation was and opened up other opportunities for you. So I suppose my comment is, could we use some of the examples of great organisations that are supported fellows to inform the organisations that will be having fellows in future, so they can just reflect on good practice and build on it.
Great point, Liz. Thanks. Maz, please.
Yes. Thank you, Sir David. I just wanted to say, I think with this fellowship, it's allowed us to also work very closely with the NHSE and I Population Health Academy. And that's been a big bonus. And the whole world can't do, you know, the population health fellowship. And alongside that, we've actually outlined the core population health competencies that we're making available for the wider NHS. So this is one of the initiatives in upskilling population health. It isn't the only one, is what I wanted to reiterate.
Okay, brilliant. Thank you. Wendy, do you want the last word?
Just to say that it's Maz's job to build on the learning and tell us how we expand this and grow it. But I think, you know, we started small so that we could really mine down into individual learning experiences. But, you know, my ambition is that we should be placing our population health fellows across ICSs as part of an opportunity for our learners to experience different ways of working, but also as partly our offer to the system. And I think this has been a really good step in that direction. And I've no doubt that people like Kelly will get snapped up. You'll have so many job offers, Kelly, you won't know where to look.
She needs to sort out Blackburn first. But anyway, that's and that's a big job, let me tell you. Okay, anybody else want to come in on this? Or should we hand the last item over to Shauna? Okay, let's move on. Big thank you, Maz, Kelly, Sanjeev, for the work on this. I really do think this is about the future and anticipating the future and preparing for this. We talked a lot about how we retrain and reskill people, and I think, Kelly, you've just spoken with great fluency about how you've added to your skills, and that prepares you then, this is Wendy's point, for you know, other steps that you might take in your career. So I'd like us as a board to think about this conversation, not just about what it adds to population health, but how it's an example of beginning to retrain the current workforce for an environment that we're going to move into. There's been lots of narrative around this more generally about the economy, and I think this is a demonstration of that. And I do wonder whether we need to convert some of this into our narrative. And Joe, I've got lots of pictures on the screen, but I'm looking at you as you look at Framework 15 refresh and how that narrative about retraining the workforce and some of the things that we've flagged up might penetrate that piece of work. This brings us to revalidation, Shauna, an important component of what we do, but just over to you for the last few minutes, please.
Thank you, David. It is an important component, but it's one that we're managing well, and I think it's important that the report comes to the board. As people will have seen, for a lot of organisations, revalidation activity has been suspended for a lot of COVID. The difference is that we feel we have a responsibility towards our trainees, and rather than just saying you're not being revalidated and then they start as consultants and GPs, and whenever the process restarted, they would then have had to go through a revalidation process, which is different to the ARC process we've been running. We put in place a mechanism to give trainees letters that would make things easier. And then when the GMC relaxed, we have worked hard to catch up so that at a time that many organisations were not actually taking forward the requirements for revalidation, we've accelerated them to make sure that all of our trainees start out on their careers confident that they have been revalidated. Now, normally there is a report that comes to the board. I'm giving you an interim report because I think it's important you're cited on the work, and it is purely to ask the board to sign off the progress we've made and demonstrate that you have confidence in me as responsible officer and the deans as the level one responsible officers delivering this. The reason for bringing it to the board is you have a duty under the responsible officer regulations to make sure that there is sufficient resource supporting this. And so this form is one used by organisations to report back to the board to show that revalidation is being properly supported. So in order that you can be confident that you are supporting is I'm providing you with a report to show our progress. And it's really, are there any questions? I don't think I need to highlight anything other than the fact that I am pleased that the teams prioritised moving the revalidation recommendations forwards for trainees.
Okay, Shauna, thanks. Questions, comments, points that people wish to make? Are we content to... sorry, Andrew.
No, carry on.
Yeah, you're there. No, you're there. You're open. Right
there. There you go. Miracles of things saying I'm muted. Looks very, very good. Very, very impressive. My question is, how many people have actually failed revalidation in this process? I.e., they've been through the process but not succeeded being revalidated.
It's not that they fail revalidation. It's what we do is we look at whether they are fit to be revalidated. And the reason that postgraduate deans are the responsible officers is part of your duty as a responsible officer under the regulations is to identify why people are not fit to revalidate and put in place programmes of work to support that. So it is actually an integral part of the postgraduate deans jobs. And there are some people where, in consultation with the GMC, there needs to be consideration of further work before they are able to be revalidated. They are our most serious training concerns, and they are a tiny number compared with the hundreds of thousands of trainees, Andrew.
But you're still picking them up through this process.
Yes, I think the revalidation process for trainees is the most robust because it involves all the ARCP processes. And so they are picked up, and trainees do not get revalidated if we're concerned. And we have a number of cases, but they are very small.
Harpreet, do you want to, having recently gone through all of this as a trainee, do you want to, if the theme of today is feedback from people that have done lived experience of this, do you want to, I don't want to put you on a spot, you can say no, but do you have a perspective on this?
Yes, I do. In that, I'm super excited by the whole process, but I think what's the challenge has been is that, sorry, Wendy, you seem slightly bewildered with that comment. But no, I think it's important because, you know, once you come out on the other side, in some ways you're kind of left on your own, right? And I think the whole process of appraisal and making sure you have the right supervisors and educators continues in order to make sure you land and you know, continue on with that professional development. I think COVID has certainly disrupted a lot of that over the last 12 months. But if I look at where I'm practicing at the moment, the last few months have been challenging, but the supervision has been and been getting much better. And I think you need that support, especially with someone who's newly qualified, to keep going on that, because otherwise it can be quite isolated and quite lonely at times, because the support you get as a trainee is not at the same level as you get as someone who's newly qualified. And we need to continue on with that and ensure that the appraisal factor that in. So on the whole, positive, but with some hopefully refresh to it in terms of how we take it forward.
Okay, brilliant. So I think you need somebody to sign this, and I nominate Naveena personally. So Naveena's thumbs up. So that's that all done. So, Shauna, thank you for this. Incredibly important work, and Harpreet's point is really very timely demonstration of why. And I think that issue about support goes to all professionals that are starting work, not just doctors. And I think the challenge is do all professionals starting work and all those that will start work this summer get the same level of support when they first start a job? I remember vividly, I feel in a sheer impotence on my first day in work when somebody said, there you are, go and do that job. It is important to remember these things as we go forward. Very, very packed agenda. Thanks all for your contributions and respecting the time. Thanks to all that have presented today and stimulated conversations an awful lot, I think, for colleagues in HEE, the executive team and throughout the organisation to be proud of has been demonstrated today. So thanks very much. And when we're out of Purdah, Lee, we can think about how we can actually just give some sunlight and oxygen to some of the work that we've seen today. So thank you very much indeed, everybody. Nicola, if I could ask you to stop the recording as I draw this public meeting to an end.